far away from my place. And you got to see a different side of me. And by that, I mean, not really. You just got to see me thriving. What's going on, everybody? I hope everyone's having a fantastic evening, afternoon, pre-noon, no matter where you are in the world. I'm Hasan Piker, and this is the Hasanabi podcast coming to you live from sunny California, Los Angeles, folks. We're live and alive, and I hope all the boys, girls, and MBs are having a fucking fantastic one because it's Thursday. It's Thursday, October 27th, 2022, and it's 11:27 a.m., and I'm actually early in comparison to the rest of the Thursdays that you're used to because on Thursdays, I normally wear pink. Just kidding. On Thursdays, I shoot leftovers. Unfortunately, Ethan Klein said some things that people absolutely utilized against him, weaponized against him, and got himself banned. My co-host on the Leftovers podcast, Ethan Klein, the man, the myth, the legend himself, fucked around once again and got himself banned for the week. And that ban was delivered immediately after Leftovers was done live recording. So that episode is now a legendary episode that you probably haven't been able to fucking hear, unfortunately for you. Between me and him, someone asked who gets canceled more. I don't know. But what I do know is I think Ethan Klein was canceled less when he was, like, a gamer. I think he gets canceled more because, like, I'm a little bit more weathered in this space. But, yeah, I think I would go so far as to say he gets canceled. He used to get canceled way less for when he was doing actual cancelable shit that he himself now looks back at and would probably cancel himself over. You know what I mean? And it's like, and the irony is that, like, back then, that shit didn't happen. You get canceled a similar amount, but if it was the current environment, but 2014, yeah, lol. It's just strange to consider that, like, you know, when he was a gamer boy, everybody loved it. They never fucking thought about it. You know what I mean? Anyway, regardless, ladies and gentlemen, boys, girls, MBs, we're here. He didn't get canceled when he was center right. He gets canceled now because he's more leftist. Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. All right, YouTube didn't give a fuck back then. No, that's not what I'm saying. Did you see Cenk saying he's voting for Caruso? I did. Yes. He's old. He's a businessman. And I disagree with that opinion of his vehemently. Like, even the underlying premises that he's launching his opinion off of, I don't like it. I don't like it at all. 8-hour debate with Cenk Wen, I don't want to even do that. I don't want to give the problem is, like, everybody fucking hates Karen Bass because, you know, she sucks. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about that. But, like, and understandably so. Karen Bass sucks. She's awful. Los Angeles has a lot of issues. Los Angeles is a blue safe haven where neoliberal policies enacted by those who are exactly like Karen Bass have destroyed the city, okay? It's like, why is the screen so bright? It's my light was on. I'll turn it off. But, like, I'm not going to fucking ever vote for a Republican instead. You know what I mean? Fuck that shit. Okay. Anyway, we'll... We'll do it. So you guys didn't film pre-leftovers? No, we didn't. And the reason for why we didn't is because Andrew last second said he's feeling under the weather and said he couldn't do it. So we didn't do it. But listen. You've gotten drunk with power? Yeah, you have. All right. Anyway, this is the part of the broadcast where I tell you a little bit about my personal news before we get into all the news. You guys are like fucking running crazy. You're running crazy and you're like, dude, come on, cover the news, cover Rick Caruso, cover Cenk, all this shit. No, the only thing I'll be covering right now is my personal news, okay? What's going on in my motherfucking life? Ladies and gentlemen, that's what we're doing right now, okay? That's what we're doing right now. And what's going on in my life is yesterday I ended the broadcast early, as you guys already know, and I drove over to a haunted house that was very far away from my place, and you got to see a different side of me, and by that, I mean, not really, you just got to see me thriving, okay, living and aliving and thriving. What do I mean by that? Well, I was fucking popping off. I was acting a fool, but also I was getting my ass handed to me by people who played Among Us way too fucking long when the meta was popping. I threw the first round, unfortunately, because we were working through the kinks of, like, how to do it, and I wasn't quick enough to figure out exactly how to do it. And that's definitely something that we had to work on there, but, you know, and then Ludwig just came in and used the exploit over and over again. But stream was great. I think the YouTube video will be great as well. Stop sending me the candid photo. It's already on the docket. We're already going to address it. Okay. We're going to address the small head allegations. Okay. We're going to do it. Shut the fuck up. My axes were on point. I think it's funny that you guys saw it. How bad everyone else's accents are. And now I think, like, because of that, you will most likely. I took a ride in an EV designed for live streamers with an NVIDIA 2080 gaming ring plus VR cameras for streaming it. There was a guy there wearing your Thrill Can Kill merch. Fuck yeah. You're all around. They're everywhere. Watch out. Hasanabi heads are everywhere. Watch out. Fucking watch out. But yeah, I ended the broadcast last night. I went over, I did the Cutie Cinderella stream. It was fucking awesome. After that, we went over to some, you know, some hookah place that Ludwig thought was going to be good, but the food was kind of mid, whatever. But there was some Hasanabi heads there working. We got some food that was mid overall. Went to sleep. Woke up this morning. Somebody fucking backed into my garage door and broke it up a little bit, and I had to fix that this entire morning. That's why I'm a little late. Yeah, That's why I'm late. There's like a film fucking crew or whatever that like backed into my shit, but it's fine. It wasn't Marat. It was not Marat. I talked to them already. I patched it up, and I'm gonna fix. I mean, it's already fixed pretty much. It's fine. It's not the big. It's not the end of the world. But yeah, I woke up to that shit, and I was like, what the fuck? And I had to work with that. But luckily, I'm sure there's a lot of memes that have come out of yesterday's interaction. I think so. Anyway, we got a lot of fucking blast off memes, and also I got a lot to talk about. So let's just get into it. Today I'm gonna have Jack Wagner from Yeah But Still podcast come and talk about his other podcast that he started, where he interviews people that have had like, you know, very spooky, very scary, very strange, you know, once in a lifetime events. So I will be talking to him as well. He'll be giving us some spooky stories, also known as Versace Tamagotchi. I also am a nominee for Streamy. Will it be full on cuties Twitch? I had to leave so halfway through. It's gonna be on the YouTube video. Will come out too. Wait, I'm up for three? I thought I was up for two. Okay, we'll look at all that. We'll look at all that. Apparently, I'm up for a Streamy. That's pretty cool. I'm not going to win it, but pretty cool regardless. Thank you for thinking of me, Streamy Awards. Very nice of you. It will be sad when I don't win, but still very nice regardless. No leftovers today. Leftists will vote for the Streamies, but not for the midterms. No one is voting for the Streamies, let's be real. I don't think you can vote for the Streamies anyway. I'm live, no leftovers. I'm up for multiple Streamies. Nominated for multiple Streamies. Talking about the Congressional Progressive Caucus and their diplomacy calls and the backlash. Russia's dirty bomb flames. Think you have the most nominations? I don't think so. Yeah, the streamer list is so stacked this year too. It's crazy. Okay. It's the Streamies. It's like the Oscars of the fucking digital world, which doesn't really mean much, but you know, what are you gonna do? The link one more time. Bitch, I fucking already put it, Oni Spumoni. You are drunk with power. Shut the fuck up. It's already in there. Oh my God. You are drunk with power. I pick a couple of your blast off tweets and you fucking go crazy, dude. Crazy. Anyway, Kanye originally wanted to title the Ye album Hitler. Yeah, I saw that. We'll be talking about that too. Ye's original name for his album was Hitler. And more news then. Does Jack no longer have a Twitter? Is M Hood in here? Does Jack no longer have a Twitter? Oh, it is. It's Jack D. Wagner. Okay, good. Okay. We'll be over to Spooky Stories from his new interview. Twitch.tv/Hasanabi. Jesus Christ. Talking about okay, there you go. It's a fat one. We made a big one with a lot of memes, okay? And because I'm not live at the normal time that I would normally be live at, I need you guys to juice this, okay? Because normally on this day, I'll be live at like 1, okay? I'd be live at 1 usually at this time. And instead, today, I'm live early, like at the normal time that I'm live at. So people are going to be confused by that. Some people are not going to get their noties. So juice this shit, okay? It's an early Thursday, baby. Let's fucking go. Did you guys enjoy last night, by the way? I'll talk about that as well a little bit more here before we fully get started. It was so much. It was good. Really good. I enjoyed it a lot. Cutie is a legend for throwing shit like that together. I would never be able to do that. Well, I'm nominated for news. That's why. Okay, that makes sense. I'm nominated for news alongside Channel 5 with Andrew Callahan. Again, the Philip DeFranco show. Okay, so let's go through my streamies. Because I've been nominated for some streamies, apparently. Or should I do that later? Okay, whatever. Maybe we'll do that later. Maybe do that in a little bit. How about that? You're nominated for news, just chatting, and streamer of the year. Yeah. You shit on theater kids, but you're the most dramatic motherfucker out of the group. No, I'm not, dude. Oh, fuck. Come on, bro. You got Ludwig. Well, I think me and Will are probably the most dramatic. You got Myth. You got Lud. There were a lot of fucking theater kids in there. If anything, the girls are like less theater kid than we are. Like they're more straightforward, straight and narrow than we are. You know what I mean? Like it's like me, Will, Ludwig, and Myth are, we're just so lame. We are so incredibly lame. We are so... Ray put an effort with the character. Yeah, Ray was like, out of the girls, like, Ray definitely put some effort into her character, but like, we were going fucking brazy with it, okay?
You sausage pocket.
How dare you, sir? I do declare! What? You, with your devilish ways and your silver tongue,
no,
seduced Mr. Plum, my lover.
What?
That's right.
You're lovers?
Yes. You've been... Yes!
You're gay, sir?
I might be! So yeah. What? Oh. Do you have a problem with that, just Mr. Green?
In the church, we teach other practices, but it's fine by me, I suppose.
I saw you browsing my wares, too, seductively.
Can you quit talking about fucking?
We're not talking about fucking, well, we're talking about the will of the Lord!
It's so bad! Oh, we're so bad, dude. We're just so bad, honestly. It's like bad theater kids. That was pretty good. Yes and for Myth. Yeah, Myth popping off with a yes and. Ludwig, Mercs, Hasan, and Will.
History will forget, Mr. Buddy.
You don't want to check his pulse?
I think I've killed him. I'm Fortnite dancing on your bodies. History will forget.
And of course, as bad as half the charm. How much research did you do about Colonel Mustard before taking on the role? Bro, what are you talking to fucking... You're making it seem like I'm a method actor or something. Yeah, dude, I'm fucking... I'm Shia LaBeouf. I actually went to the Serengeti. Did a little bit of big game hunting before I could get into character. As you know, Colonel Algernon Jebediah Mustard. Thank you for my service. Was... a decorated war veteran and a big game hunter. That's right. Hasan is gone. I am now Colonel Algernon Mustard. Mustard. The Luddy is going viral. The Luddy is now in Kaisen ass dance rotation. That's hilarious. That's crazy. It's wild because, like, dude, he is so much. God damn it, dude. He hit the Luddy so hard. It's the Kaisenati now. Like, that's insane. Black people can literally make anything look cool. I mean, Kai is a very unique entertainer. I don't think this has anything to do with him being black, but should not have read that. But he is very good. Appropriating white culture, shaking my head. Bro, it's no longer white culture. Okay? It's no longer, this is no longer white culture, okay? The Luddy has escaped white culture in a very unique moment. For the first time in the history of culture, which oftentimes is, you know, white people robbing black people and doing culture vulture shit. For the first time ever, it has gone in the exact opposite direction, and now it's over. It's done. It's no longer white culture. You can't do the Luddy now. It's cultural appropriation. Those guys manifested it by saying some Ludwig ass motherfucker, and here we are. Yeah. Your streaming link for your streamer of the year goes to your Ukraine invasion coverage. Wait, really? Oh my god, people are gonna get so fucking mad at that, and literally act like I was fucking pro-Russia or some shit. So, people forget, like, I was thinking about this morning, right? So, I got nominated for a bunch of streamies, right? Including my news, including in the news category. I got nominated for a streamie for, you know, I think best just chatting streamer. But here, let's go through it, okay? Here is the 12th annual nominees for the Streamy Awards, okay? Creator of the Year is Addison Ray, Airac, Blogalades, Charlie D'Amelio, Dream, Gideon, Logan Paul, Mark Rober, Mr. Ball, and Mr. Beast. Show of the Year goes to Challenge Accepted, Chicken Shop Date, Good Mythical Morning, Hot Ones, oh, fucking Sean Evans once again. My mortal enemy. I spent a day with Anthony Padilla, In Space with Markiplier, RDC World. Oh shit, RDC World. Nice. Side Talk, Twitch Rivals. By WoW Presents. Stream of the Year is Hasanabi, I Show Speed, Kaisenat, Kaide, Ludwig, Pokemon, Quackity, Tauduk, Valkyrie, and XQC. We got two Turks up there. That's crazy. Two fucking Turks, man. How wild is that? Two Turks in the Stream of the Year Awards. That's crazy to me, okay? Anyway, that's pretty fire. I'll be real. I don't think I'm going to win any of these, okay? Because I was thinking about it, and I was like, there's no shot I win any of these because, like, you know, my qualities are that, you know, I'm good at community building. I'm a consistent streamer. I'm probably the most consistent streamer out of anyone in any list, right? Because as one of the top streamers on this platform and in the world at this point, I am super consistent. I do the news every fucking day. But that in and of itself is not exactly going to push the fucking needle. Like, that's not going to... That's not going to, you know, and XUC as well, obviously, is another person who is profoundly consistent. I would say it's like me and XUC are the two most consistent streamers on this list, but that doesn't mean anything. XUC is more consistent. Brother, we have literally both streamed every single day with exceptions, unless like XUC is literally dying, he doesn't stream, and it's the same for me. How are you going to say X is more consistent? Like, there are not enough days in the fucking year for us to be fighting each other over this, okay? But anyway, the point is, consistency is not key here, right? Consistency is not key here. XU doesn't take Sundays off. That's funny you should say that, because neither do I, motherfucker. I say that I'm going to. The only XU streams 16 plus hours with ease. I know. He streams a lot more than I do. That is 100% a fact. I'm saying, though, that, like, consistency as in, like, I, every day at 11 a.m. Pacific, you know I'm going to be here. I'm talking about a schedule. XUC is like literally, he streams nonstop. He's a demon. I'm not saying that I stream more than he does. He streams more than I do, of course. Regardless though, so, but consistency is not key in this person, in this process. Consistency is not the important thing in this process. Because Kai Sinat does a lot of very unique streams. Even iShow Speed, I think, does a lot of very unique streams. Ludwig does a lot of very unique streams. He literally fucking creates new metas. He absolutely is like, these guys are pushing boundaries, right? So there is that reality, and I think, like, I haven't done too much of that because my style of commentary and content does not lend itself to that as much. So I think that that is one thing that I have going against me. Okay, that's definitely one thing I have going against me in a category like this. But having said that, I thought about a lot. I thought about this a lot. Like, what do I do? What do I bring to the table? And I was thinking, like, what do I bring to the table? Like, if we were looking at this seriously, right? If we're looking at this seriously, because, like, my immediate reaction was, I'm not going to win any of this shit, okay? Because, like, I don't have a very high view of myself. I think these guys are fucking brilliant. They're talented. They're incredible streamers. They're incredible content creators in general. And what I was thinking, like, what do I bring to the table is, like, yeah, what I do is very unique. And it's not very easy to replicate. And more importantly than that, like, this community has grown. And as it has grown, it has created a bunch of, you know, community leaders, community organizers, labor union organizers. Like, there's so much influence that this community has in general that is not exactly replicable in any meaningful capacity. And also on top of that, like, we've raised hundreds of thousands of dollars over the course of the past year on all of these important issues that I've talked about. So there's that too. You know what I mean? Like, there is definitely a lot of you and Hulal. There is certainly a lot of people that, I mean, there's certainly a lot that this community does. Like, there's certainly a lot that, that I bring to the table as a streamer that I think, like, you know, I understand why I would be on here. Russia has invaded Ukraine. This is what they linked it to? Oh, my God. Everyone's going to get so fucking mad at that. Honestly, you're extremely consistent with your content. Your streams are never boring, but they're never, like, exceptional, I guess. times when you brought some cool guests or like your peaks, usually BB No Money is a great example. But like when I have guests on, people don't actually fucking. When I have guests on, people don't even fucking appreciate that content, I don't think. I think you're selling yourself short. You got a lot of variety. Blacksmith, Coachella, cancellation streams, anime expo, TwitchCon, politics, gaming collabs, guests, true world impact, fundraising, among just chatting reacts. Yeah. But we'll see. We'll see what happens. But, you know, we got that. So international is a category that is tiny, in my opinion. Short form, DeMarcus Shawn, Ian Boggs, Savannah Moss, Sheena Milwani, and the Cheeky Boyos. Individual awards, breakout character, Ben of the Week, Call Me Chris, Kristen Titus, Mr. Ballin, Ryan Trahan. I'm not entirely familiar with these guys. Breakout streamer, Emiru, iShowSpeed, Kai Sinat, K-Katamina. Ooh, look at that. Myung mentioned. Nice. Cutie Cinderella. Nice. Collaboration, Ludwig, My Game Show Broke YouTube. Mr. Beast Extreme, $1 million hide and seek. Mark Rober, Just Dustin, Hacksmith Industries Unspeakable, first YouTuber to break the orbit wins 10K. Sam and Colby, Call Me Chris, Selena Spooky Boo, our inexplainable night at Crescent Hotel. You don't even react to shows anymore, and I think that might help you in the awards. Creator for Social Good, Invisible People, Mr. Ballin, Mr. Beast and Mark Rober, hashtag Team C's, Ryan Tran, Feeding America, The Game Theorist, St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital. Creator product they have, Happy Dad by Nelk, Holo Taco by friend of the show, Simply Nailogical, Prime Hydration, Popflex by Blogilates, and Feastables by Mr. Beast. Crossover, Dwayne The Rock Johnson, Gordon Ramsay, Haley Road Bieber, Lily Reinhardt, Camila Mendez, and Madeline Pesht. And Post Malone in first person. What does that mean? Why is Gideon on first person? We got just chatting streamers. In the category of just chatting, you have Bruce, drop him off. You have me, Hasanabi, once again. When you click on my name, it takes you to something that doesn't exist, though. That's interesting. Why don't they just like click? What? Okay. Kai Sinat, Quackity, and XQC. I mean, this is a fat list, dude. I'm going up against some fucking demons, dude. I mean, this is crazy. You got Quackity. Quackity has international appeal. Like, I mean, he's a brilliant content creator. Love him. You have Kai Sinat, also incredible, entertaining, unique. You have Bruce Dropimoff, same. Incredibly entertaining, blowing up, great content creator. You have XQC, same with that. I mean, it's crazy that these are some of the best content creators on the fucking planet that I have to go up against for just chatting. It's not, you know, I'm getting cooked on that. XQC doesn't even do just chatting. I don't know why the fuck they put him in that category. He's a variety streamer. XQC is more of a variety streamer than any of these other streamers. Asmongold is on the variety list. Lyric, Ludwig, Moist Critical, and Valkyrie are going up against one another. On VTuber, you have Code Miko, Iron Mouse, Nyaners, Vebe, Zentria. On podcast, you got Caller Daddy, H3 Podcast, the most canceled podcast in America, Impulsive, Mr. Ballin Podcast, and On Purpose with Jay Shetty. On the scripted series, you have, oh my God, Darmon Mention, I'm Losing It. In Space with Markiplier, Jackpop, Normal British Series, and RDC World. I really wish RDC World wins something on this one. They're so goated. Unscripted Series, Challenge Accepted, Chicken Shop Date, I Spent the Day, Side Talk, Subject Awards, Animated. I'm skipping some of these. Beauty, Bailey Sarian, Brad Mondo, Michaela Noguera, Miss Darcy, Nikki Tutorials. Comedy, Adrian Bliss, Call Me Chris, RDC World, Rich Black Guy, and The McFarlanes. Commentary, you got, Chad, Danny Gonzalez, Drew Gooden, Jarvis Johnson, and Legal Eagle. This lineup is stacked as fuck. Like all of my favorite content to react to. You know what I mean? Look at that. And competitive gaming side, that's a stacked-ass list, too. You got It's Timmy, Nick Merckx, Shroud, Taruk, and Tens. On dance, you got B-Dash and Ola Bedard. I don't know anything like here. Fashion and style, you got Gunner, Death the Rage, Kenz Lauren, Mina Lee, Nikita Dragon, Wisdom K. On food, Babish Culinary Universe, Cooking with Linja, Nick DiGiovanni, Side Serve Cake Studio, Uncle Roger, Gamer. Wait, what is this? There's like competitive gamer and then gamer. Afmao, Dream, Laserbeam, Markiplier, and Tommy Innit. Health and wellness, kids and family, learning and education, lifestyle. And then news is another category that I was nominated for. My management just texted me, actually. It said I was nominated for 4. I don't know why. But Brian Tyler Cohen, Channel 5 with Andrew Callahan, Gay News with Josh Helfgott, me, Hasanabi, and the Philip DeFranco Show. I don't know what the fourth thing would be, though. Science and Engineering. Ooh, I did a thing is up. That's fire. That makes me happy. Sports, technology. Ooh, Linus Tech Tips. Cinematography, editing, visual and special effects, writing, brand of the year, agency of the year, brand management, and then the rest of this is just like brand shit. But I don't know, influencer campaign, social impact campaign. What is the fourth one that I'm on? I think you need to realize that you're on a list with people you think are awesome because people think you are awesome. No, I'm on 3. I don't know why my management said 4. I'm on 3. Maybe they counted H3 podcast too because of the leftovers. I think. Or it's just like, you know, competitive gaming, I guess. But yeah, no, that makes me happy. It makes me happy. A lot of my friends are being recognized. You know, a lot of these incredible content creators are being recognized. Obviously, this kind of stuff always leaves some people behind no matter what happens, right? There are plenty of people that also are more deserving of this. There are plenty of people that are also deserving of being mentioned. And unfortunately, if they don't get it, I mean, you know, don't worry, I'm not going to win anything, so it doesn't really matter. I would say, like, Jerma. For example, in, like, you know, he has made a lot of really unique content over this past year. You know what I mean? I think that that is like pretty, pretty important, but they didn't pay for it. Yeah, no, totally. Because I did, I paid so much money to the streamies, to make sure that I get nominated. But I guess Jerma was not nominated because he's not real. You know? I suspect that that's the main reason why he didn't get nominated. Like, you have to be, like, a real human. Or because he's going to prison for murder. That could be another reason why. I wish he was, though. Politics? You made this up. That's not a real category. That'd be really funny if Matt Gaetz was on there, though. Last night, Goomba confirmed. Okay, I need to address something. Before we get to the news, I need to address something. Last night, I saw a tweet, and I wanted to call it out, okay? But before I show you the tweet here, we're going to juice this one more time. We're going to juice this tweet one more time, okay? Because, you know, it's like I said, I'm earlier than usual, which is, not normal for Thursdays. So I suspect that people are not, you know, coming in. They don't fucking know that I'm live, okay? So anyway, Steven Crowder calls Kamala a whore. Nice. Classic. Yeah. Last night, you know, we did some dressing up. I was Colonel Mustard, okay? I was Colonel Mustard. And then I saw something on the website, on this fucking website, okay, on Twitch, or on Twitter, a website not famous for slander. I mean, not famous for lies, but famous for the truth. I saw something that hurt my soul. Okay, I saw slanderous statements. You will be, Addy Online, you will be getting a call from my lawyers, okay? Not lawyer, lawyers, plural. Do you understand me? This person said, someone pointed this out and now I can't unsee. And that's like, oh, what is that? It's a photo of just, you know, two best friends hanging out. What is that? What's that about? Oh, you think this is funny? Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's really funny, right? Isn't it? Really funny. It's not. It's not funny. Stop laughing at my normal-sized head. Oh, stop photoshopping photos. My head's already tiny. What the fuck's wrong with you? Megaphonics loves doxing himself. It's kind of crazy. I've never met someone who's like, please dox me. Like, why'd you send me that, Megaphonics? Why'd I even click on that? Like, God damn it. He's like, hey, this is my relative with his fucking Christian government name. Hello. What's wrong with you, bro? Stop sending me shit like that. Half the time, I need to ban this motherfucker for his own good. Wait, what happened? Bro, you sent me text messages from your relative with your relative's, like, full Christian government name on there, brother. What's that? What's up with you? What is this poll? Do you think his small head is funny? Yes? No, but actually yes? What the fuck? There's a fucking mod mutiny in here. It's not funny. It's actually not funny. It is unfunny, okay? Not funny. Stop laughing. Stop laughing at my small head. I mean, my average sized head. This you? Yeah, that's me, man. That's the normal size of my head. The funniest part is I can't tell if this is Photoshop. No, this is not Photoshop. That's just how it looks, okay? That's just fucking how it looks in this photo. I'm sick and tired of this fucking slander, okay? Stop body shaming me. Only time motherfuckers vote is when there's a dumbass poll in the chat about whether they think my head is like comically small or not. That is fucked up, dude. That is actually fucked. You understand me? That's so fucked. Here's something to boost your ego in a completely normal-sized head. Thank you. That helped, but there's only 44. Someone's at 14 FPS. Ego boost? I doubt that any of this is going to give me a fucking ego boost. Find out that Haas sperm is unable to fertilize because small head. Yeah, thanks for the ego boost, man. That was real funny. Can't believe they nominated Ludd for this best cake. I destroy him. That's not even funny. That actually, okay. Small head stuff, funny. This is one area where I am so fucking confident in mine, dude. That's crazy. That's not even, you know. Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2, not a commentary on current events, developer says. Yeah, bro. No, for real. That's right. That's so true. Yeah, when they make you kill Soleimani with a fucking rocket and the guy looks exactly like Soleimani, they're just fucking around. That's just not a commentary on anything, really. But yeah, it's pretty cool. The streaming shit is pretty cool. Okay, we got Jack Wagner. We're going to talk about Kanye West and Hitler. We talked about Kai hitting the Luddy. This hot dude on Tinder left me hanging earlier this year, and now look who's come crawling back. Okay, awesome. Maybe we can go to a bar if you like. Yeah, I live near. A bar sounds exciting. I knew it was you on the Hasanabi stream. What the fuck? SDL. Unfortunately, you know, now that he's a Hasan fan, so he's back to a 0 out of 10. 300 likes? Who are these people? Like, they should be getting vaporized, okay? What a fucking psychotic take. Wait, is my title still No Leftovers Live Soon? I feel like there's still a fucking community of motherfuckers who just, like, shit on me every time they have, like, an opportunity that, but, like, from the left. Anyway. What is that shit you drink every day? It's cold brew. Okay. Russia dirty bomb. I think SDL is a fan. Okay. Well, if I misunderstood it, then my bad. Okay. SDL is a pretty fascist for tweets and Discord messages. So yeah, not left. I don't know. I don't care. People can change their minds. Stop saying ego boost and then linking me the dumbest shit. What is this? I'm so drunk at Hasan the Hun. Hasan. Okay. Juniper tweeted. Juniper got involved in the Don't Tell Hasan meta. She said, Don't tell Hasan you went goblin mode. Every day we get one of these now, okay? Every day. Shouts out to Prezzo for destroying me, okay? Yet another instance where it's not even my fucking haters, it's my fans that are ruining me, okay? Ruining my fucking life. Anyone that wants to post a fucking selfie uses it as an opportunity to say I'm a fucking gay basher or a trans basher. Or just like an LGBT enemy, okay? It's ridiculous. Tucker Carlson's about to be like, what's going on? A new hero has risen through the ranks of the left. A person who's taken matters to his own hands, beating every trans person he can get his hands on. He calls himself an LGBT foe. And in modern America, that is something you can't do. But this man, Hasan Piker, has been able to achieve such impressive feats. It's a meme? No, yeah, it is a meme. I'm fucking around. Okay. If you don't like it, then stop attacking all these trans people. I can't stop myself. I can't stop myself, man. Yeah, Kanye West called his album, wanted to call his album Hitler. We're going to talk about that. We're going to finish the COD campaign. Also, COD Modern Warfare multiplayer is out today. We might do that as well. Funny vibes. This clip from Tucker last night with custom. Tucker last night was custom made for Hasan Rage Law. Okay, that's going to make me fucking go crazy. Emma Rips Jank, the anti-establishment candidate, is the former Republican billionaire real estate tycoon. So many of these problems can be traced back to housing. Caruso will give real estate developers free reign. That can only exacerbate the conditions you describe. Yeah, 100%. That is, I mean, Emma put it perfectly. Rick Caruso literally has a fucking boulevard named after him at the Grove, okay? He is the real estate developer responsible for one of the most awful monstrosities in Los Angeles, also known as The Grove. I despise it. I have so much hate in my heart for The Grove. I go there every now and then because it has a movie theater in it, but like, I do not like it, okay? Rick Caruso is a famous billionaire real estate developer and a lifelong Republican who is running for mayor in Los Angeles. He's running as a Democrat in Los Angeles, and he's been hosting a fuckload of meetings, okay? Closed-door meetings with, like, famous people, celebrities, rich people in general, as he tries to get them on his side, talking about fucking crime and homelessness, okay? Those are his two main focuses. Now, there is an issue with crime and homelessness in Los Angeles. Of course, the issue is caused by motherfuckers like Rick Caruso. It's wild to me that we're now at a stage where we're looking at a situation where it's like, oh, yeah, I guess the only person that can solve crime and homelessness is the motherfucker causing it. Okay? We have homelessness because housing is insanely unaffordable. That is the main reason for homelessness. I've talked about this a million, gorillion fucking times. I don't know what else to say. There is so much evidence, okay? It is wild that people are still like, la, 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 can't hear you. Homelessness might be personal responsibility, something else. It's mental health. It's like, okay, we'll fix that then. No, won't do it. Crime is also a consequence of poverty, okay? If your goal is to just continue pumping more funds into the multiple billion-dollar fund-receiving Los Angeles Police Department as we have done for as long as we have been here, okay, as long as I've been in LA at least, if your goal to solve crime is not social programs, social safety nets, and to eviscerate poverty, but instead to fund more, police armored personnel carriers or whatever the fuck, so they can sit around in a crime scene and you know, twiddle their goddamn thumbs and not really do anything and complain about the reason why they can't do their job is because they can't kill fucking 14-year-old Latino and black teenagers without scrutiny, then we're fucked. If you think the way to deal with homelessness is by over-policing homeless people, doing street sweeps, and then pushing them out to, like, other areas, okay? Just pushing them away. Just put all the homeless people in Skid Row. Then you're fucked. That's not going to fix the problem. There will always be a new supply of homeless people, because people are getting priced out of housing. Why are they getting priced out of housing? Because real estate developers do not want affordable housing in Los Angeles. They do not want to increase the inventory of affordable housing in Los Angeles. Why? Because that means that their inventory of housing keeps going up in price. That, therefore, they make more money. Their value, their company's valuations go up. Their overall capital goes up. Why would you? Why would you push back against that? And the insanity is assuming that, like, Rick Caruso, a guy like Rick Caruso, is going to fucking actually what is this? Oh, dude, what the fuck? Come get your uncle, dog. This constant whining to try to get Hasan to correct me is really dumb. I don't know what his position on Bass is. No, we've talked about it. I don't like Karen Bass. I told him. I think Karen Bass sucks. I think his criticisms of Karen Bass are valid, okay? Jake's criticisms of Karen Bass are valid. She's a fake progressive, okay? Bernie is endorsing her, okay? Bernie's endorsing her. Why? Because there's no other alternative. But if he likes her, I'm happy to do an 8-hour debate on that. This is not an endorsement of Caruso. This is me vomiting about how awful establishment Democrats are. I mean, that's true, but then he did kind of endorse him, right? He said, yes. Are you voting for Caruso? Yes. Karen Bass's main message seems to be that she's an establishment Democrat, no interest, who thinks things in LA are generally fine. They're not, and will work the system better. The problem is the system. There's nothing but incompetence and corruption here. We need change. And there's a very real problem here. I think that Jenk is genuine, okay? It's not like Jeffrey Katzenberg told him to fucking vote for Rick Caruso or whatever. You guys are so stupid if you think that that's the reason. No, there is another underlying reason there, okay? Jenk is a relatively rich person who is old and sees a lot of crime and sees how fucking corrupt the Democratic Party has been in California and thinks he can shake things up with who? A fucking psychotic Republican billionaire? Worst idea ever. Okay? But the problem here isn't just Jenk. The problem here isn't like trying to figure out the puzzle pieces to see if there's like any other reason why Jenk is doing this. No, the problem is there's a lot of people in Los Angeles like this. I've been talking about this for years, okay? I've been talking about this for the past couple of years. If you recognize, every time I talk about crime coverage, crime in Los Angeles coverage, I always talk about all the fucking rich Democrat motherfuckers I know and how fascist they get when they talk about homeless people. Okay? That is a consequence of all the fucking Instagram accounts that have propped up. That is a consequence of all the local media coverage. That's a consequence of the local media working in unison with the LAPD to make it seem like the LAPD is being shackled by the Democrats and these progressive DAs, right? Which is bullshit. That's fucking bullshit. Los Angeles Police Department is not doing its best. But also, if I'm going to be fucking honest about the Los Angeles Police Department, it's not their job. It shouldn't be the job of the police to fucking literally reduce crime. We have such a fucked up, weird, brain-broken understanding where, like, every American thinks, like, no, crime fighting and vigilante justice is how you fucking solve crime. No, you solve crime at the systemic issues, okay? You can't fucking solve crime by throwing more money into a pile of fucking hot dog skinned potato sack dickheads that have guns and no accountability whatsoever. The real world is not like fucking Batman, dude.
Well, this is where...
Anyway, we'll continue on this, all right? Most people, even hella capitalists, fully know about the whole supply-demand scam that is the diamond industry and agree it sucks. Literally, the same thing is happening with housing, so how come no one ever draws the similarities so that they maybe understand? Because there's a lot more... Diamonds are owned by, like, 8 fucking families, but housing is owned by every American. It's like the same concept of... It's the same concept as 401ks. 401ks have created a system where Americans care more about the fucking stock market than anything else because they're like, well, my 401k is down 30%. That's because of Brandon. 401ks have created a system where they believe that, where the average American believes that they have a genuine vested fucking interest in the stock market and it's in improving the stock market. When in fact, your future should not be reliant on a 401k from the stock market. And the gains that are being made in the stock market are overwhelmingly going to the top 10% of wealth. And the losses are actually the only thing that socializes within the stock market. The gains are still held pretty fucking tightly. You're making like marginal improvements on your 401k. In the normal world, in the reality, and yet, no, you should still fucking contribute to your 401k. There's no other alternative. I will never tell you not to fucking have a comfortable nest egg for yourself. You should not have to work your entire life. You shouldn't work until you're fucking 75 because Social Security is clearly not going to cover it. Please do not misunderstand me. I've always talked about this. I've talked about this for years and years and years, okay? But there used to be a system. In a perfect world, there would be pensions, even though that is also a faulty system in and of itself because that's still employment-based. And also on top of that, you would have Social Security coverage, okay? Unions and union-backed pensions and Social Security should be able to help you retire. But because that's not enough, because that's completely inadequate, now instead of pensions, we have 401ks. Everything is privatized. You mean we shouldn't have police at all? I'm in the most respectful way possible. I'm just trying to see what you mean here. Do you mean we shouldn't have police at all and strictly deal with crime at a systemic level? I'm slightly confused at your take, and I'd like an elaboration. Sure, certainly. I believe that policing as an institution, if we think about it as a theory, a group of individuals that get together, have that maintain the presence of law and order and like solve crimes like detectives are supposed to do, all that shit, and maybe even in certain instances, make sure that certain antisocial people that are demonstrating violent antisocial urges need to stay away from the rest of society, that is valid. That has to exist, okay? It does not matter if it is a... It does not matter if it's an anarchist, democratically organized formation of community watchers or whatever the fuck you want to call it. That has to still exist as a concept. I have always maintained that position, okay? No matter what happens, you need some people to be like, hey, that's wrong. You can't do that. You know, don't break the rules. However, the way that policing works in the United States of America and globally, I would say, the way that policing works in a capitalist system is to side with the capital, to place the interests of capital over the interests of citizens. It says protect and serve, right? On the side of the fucking cop cars. But the real protecting and serving that is happening in the way that policing works under capitalism is protecting and serving the interests of capital. I am not the type of person who says, like, no, I think our communities would be fine without any cops whatsoever. I've never maintained that position. I don't think that. There is, of course, going to be a place for people to you know, maintain the presence of law and order. However, in a lot of black and brown communities and a lot of poor communities, the presence of police do not actually create a presence of law and order. It creates lawlessness and disorder. Okay, so that's one. In immediately, like off the bat, cops are not doing what they are theoretically supposed to do. Okay. But ultimately, the way to solve issues of violent crime, a lot of violent crime, property theft, grand larceny, these sorts of crimes, okay, or organized like retail theft or whatever the fuck, that is not, you don't solve that by making cops get better guns, okay, by giving cops better guns, giving cops better weapons, or allowing them to murder people on site. You solve that at the systemic level because the root cause of crime is socioeconomic conditions. Okay? Motherfuckers with more to lose are not going to fucking steal or do dumb shit. That's just the truth. It's the simplest way I can put it. If you have a bright future ahead of you, you are most likely not going to fuck shit up. If you're going to school and you're learning shit, you have, you know, after school programs, you have friends, you have an opportunity to go to college, you have an opportunity to help your family and your community, you're not going to fuck that shit up. You are significantly less likely to go and fucking steal. You are significantly less likely to go and you know, get a gun and do some crazy shit. It's super simple, and for some weird reason, we just cannot comprehend it. We think like, nah, you don't understand, bro. Like, nah, people are just like inherently violent, or it's rap music, or it's rap culture, or whatever the fuck. It's like, no, dude. There are people in enclaves in this fucking country living in third world developing nation conditions. There are places in Alabama where black communities do not have working sewage systems, okay? That is a disaster, that is an injustice that has not been solved, and it is directly a consequence of our white supremacist foundations, okay? It's insane. It's completely unacceptable. And we don't do anything about it. White collar crime is as if not more common than street crime, though the societal damages are much higher. The system just doesn't care about it for the reason you state, protecting the interests of capital. Yeah, wage theft is the largest percentage of theft that happens, okay, across the board. Like, when you look at actual theft in this country, you would think like, oh man, cars are being stolen crazy at crazy rates. Grand Theft Auto, right? Or property crime is happening at an alarming rate. No, motherfucker, it's wage theft. And it impacts pretty much every single fucking person. And it's being done by pretty much every single employer. But because we live in a capitalist system, that is just completely cast aside. No one even thinks about it. It's like multiple X's too, like multipliers. So, Aaron Hernandez was a millionaire football player and killed people, right? He was well off and did bad shit. So, I don't think it's 100% at all, but white supremacy, Lamont. Wait, what? Is that what you got out of what I just said to you? I understand that there's still motherfuckers who are going to do, like, antisocial, violent, psychopathic, criminal shit. I'm not saying you eliminate serial killers by eliminating poverty, dumbass. Also, you're literally talking about a dude whose brain was fucking the size of a goddamn walnut as a consequence of being slammed into other 400-pound men for his entire adult life. The fuck are you talking about, dude? Why do you think he did that? Because that was his only way of upward social mobility, right? That's crazy. I can't believe this guy with demonstrable mental illness created by fucking concussions. As like wealthier billionaires fucking make, extract the gigantic chunk of his labor value, sit there and you know, keep adding more billions into their fucking wealth. That dude broke his fucking brain so hard he went and like did a shitload of psychotic violent crimes that are directly linked back to his CTE. So the example that you used is even worse than that. You could have just used like fucking, you know, any number of serial killers if that's what your argument is. If like, oh, well, you can't solve serial killers. I agree, you can't. Anyway. There's a lot of links as well between which groups in society are disenfranchised versus the ethnicity of the current combat sports champions. Back in the day, a lot of boxing champs were Jewish and Irish because they were so economically fucked. Yeah, we use the poorest people in our society as like gladiators for our own personal entertainment. I mean, that much is pretty obvious, right? Mr. Hasanabi, can you explain why yous dinna have pensions in America? That's crazy, dude. My man said, yous dinna have pensions in America. capitalism. Anyway. That's the same reason why at the top of the hour, there's a 60-second ad break. That's the same reason why in order to avoid those ads, all you need to do is subscribe for $5 or for free. Okay, Twitch Prime is free as long as you have an Amazon Prime account connected to your Twitch account where you get one free Prime subscription a month. That's the reason why you can also get lucky and get gifted a sub by those who are more fortunate than you in order to also avoid the ads. Okay. Here's the woman ad break now. One Slice Gal, thank you for the 5-2 and gifted subs. So yeah, Jank is talking about Karen Bass. This is like made a lot of this had a lot of momentum because, you know, he is a very famous progressive liberal leftist, whatever you want to fuck call it. Not really a leftist all that much, but a social democrat. Talking about, you know, how much he despises Karen Bass. Yeeter Zeeter, thank you for the 5, get the subs. And One Slice Gal and Sad Econ Major, thank you for the 5, get the subs. I think that crime and homelessness is a gigantic issue in Los Angeles, okay? It is. It is a huge, huge issue. And I don't just mean like it's a huge issue in the sense that like it sucks that there are homeless people living on the streets. Obviously, first and foremost, that is the gigantic problem, okay? But it's also an issue for everyone else. It's a matter of public safety, both for the homeless people that are that do not have shelter. But it's a matter of public safety for a lot of the people that live around some of the homeless people that will then go and do crazy shit. I mean, the reality is, like, if you're devoid of shelter, if you haven't had shelter for years and years and years and years, yeah, your brain's gonna fucking break. Where'd you buy your headband from? It's a t-shirt whose, I cut the sleeves off. It's a t-shirt sleeve. Okay? And it's happening everywhere. It's happening all around the motherfucking country, okay? People are desperate, they're hungry, they're starving. Their mental health is like diminishing at an alarming rate. They're living in the fucking streets, they're eating trash, they're taking shits on the side of the fucking road. Yeah. That's not good. That's terrible. And it's happening in the wealthiest nation on the fucking planet. And there are places that have been able to eviscerate the homelessness problem, okay? And I don't mean in the fascist sense. I mean tackle the root cause. Okay? You need to have a housing first approach to homelessness. You need to put homeless people in homes. That's it. But that is unimaginable. Okay? That is fucking unimaginable. When I bring this up, people lose their minds. They're like, what? But they don't even realize, like, bro, that could be you one day. Okay? People think that that is just unimaginable and unjustifiable because people can imagine the end of the world before they can imagine the end of capitalism, okay? Housing is a fundamental plank of wealth building in this country. We don't see homes as shelter, a necessary resource for survival. We see it as a leg up, a way to generate wealth for future generations. And that has created demonstrable problems. That is the reason why everyone with a home thinks, oh man, it sure is great that housing prices are constantly going up in my neighborhood, which is adding on to the wealth that I have because one day I might sell my house. But even if I don't sell my house, I can simply, you know, take loans against it. It's collateral. I can take loans against it, and the more its price goes up in 10 years, the more loans I can take out against it, right? And for that reason, you just don't want more housing. You don't want more available. You don't want more availabilities. You don't want more inventory. Why do you think it hasn't at least been patched up for optics? Do you think it's a long-term strategy? Because under capitalism, it's about what you can get away with. Okay? Those who own capital will do everything in their power to continue squeezing as much as they possibly can. Your boss is always going to pay you as little as he possibly can and get the most work out of you for the least amount of pay. This contradiction is at the heart. This class contradiction is at the heart of capitalism. Your boss, your manager, operating at the behest of your boss, wants you to work as many hours as you physically, humanly can while giving you the least amount of money he can get away with. You want to work the least amount of hours that you possibly could get away with, and you want the most amount of pay you can get out of that. It's just normal, right? Of course, those with power, those with money, those with a consolidation of wealth and power at the top get to make those choices for you. They win that every time. And the same goes for the housing market. The same goes for every area where capital exists. Those who own houses want to make sure that their housing prices go up because that is their wealth. If there was more inventory of housing readily available, then all of a sudden, because there's not enough scarcity of this resource, your house as a commodity would lose its value. And if it started losing its value, you would lose money. It's like money out of your pocket. That's crazy. I was worth, you know, my house is worth $3 million, but then next year, it's all of a sudden, it's only worth $2 million. No, I just lost $1 million. Like, it's theoretical money, but it's still money in the way that people understand it. It's not liquid. But do you get what I'm saying? It's insane. The housing market cools and builders are not building homes anymore, even though they could still make a decent profit. People are freaking the fuck out because their homes are worth 5% less than they were last year. Yeah. Meanwhile, their houses are already inflated 30% from like 5 years ago. So in that process, they work to make sure that the inventory is dry and they make sure that they don't want any new fucking developments because construction also is like disruptive. You know what I mean? If they're building a fucking, if you live in a single family house, okay, and then all of a sudden they're building an apartment next door to you, what the fuck? There's construction, there's loud noise, it's disruptive. You don't want that. That's where you get the NIMBYs. The not in my backyarders, okay? That is one other reason why they don't want housing to be built. Okay? And lastly, when that happens, when these guys get together, real estate developers and the like, when they say, hey, we got to maintain the fucking, you know, profit margins for our homes and all this shit, and they dictate policy, okay? They stop new housing from being built, or whenever new housing is being built, it's always like luxury condominiums and shit with like maybe 10% of that going to like affordable housing, but that's on a lottery system and that's not actually filling anything. You know what I mean? That's not filling the need in a meaningful capacity. In affordable housing, neighborhoods that have affordable housing and old units are being fucking eviscerated and gentrified at a rapid, alarming clip. All of that is pushing people that live in those neighborhoods away, further and further away from the Los Angeles metropolitan area. But those people still have to work in the Los Angeles metropolitan area, but now their commute is longer. They're spending more money on gas. Their lives are becoming worse overall. It's becoming unmanageable for them. until they ultimately fuck up for one reason or the other and maybe lose their job. And now you're jobless. Now you maybe can't even pay the fucking rent in the previously affordable neighborhood that you were living in that is less and less affordable now. Year over year, your landlord is increasing your rent, and now you're fucked. You can't pay for it. Boom. All of a sudden, you have housing insecurity. All of a sudden, you're either couch surfing or you're living out of your car, okay? That's what I call tier three homelessness, okay? You're in the, if the homelessness is like tiered and structured for people to understand, if you want to contextualize it a little bit better, I call that tier three homelessness. It's the first stage of homelessness. There's probably a lot of people in here that, there's probably some people in here that are living in that stage right now. You just, you're housing insecure. You don't know, you don't have like sustainable, like 100% housing that you always know that you can live in. Okay. Once you get to living out of your car, things start going downhill. Okay. Things start going downhill even further. It makes it harder for you to keep your job. Okay. All of a sudden, you have to find a place where you can take showers, find a place where you can clean your clothes. These things that we take for granted in the form of real estate, in the form of like a shelter over our heads that we all take for granted, is actually something that can go away like that. Okay. These people are invisible homeless people. Okay. You don't understand that they're homeless. There might be people in your lives that are living like this right now, and that starts taking a toll on their mental health. It makes it harder for them to keep a job. Then you move on to tier two homelessness, where it is basically the transitional state from like being a transitional state between like going from a car to an actual house to living on the streets. You lose your car, you can't make car payments. You lose your car because, you know, it gets impounded because it's criminalized. You can't live in your fucking car. Then all of a sudden you live on the streets. That is what you see. That's the visible homeless people that you see. That's tier three homelessness. Now, in tier two, when you start living on the fucking streets, you have no shelter whatsoever. Now you're literally combating the elements day in, day out. Things have gotten much harder for you, okay? You start self-medicating because it is deeply traumatic as an existence, as an experience. So now what are you doing? You're taking drugs, okay? You start shooting up to deal with the pain every single fucking day. Now you start to develop an addiction. Your brain is fucking rotting every fucking day as a consequence of sleep deprivation, as a consequence of the trauma and the fear that you have, that you don't have shelter over your own fucking head. This is literally like animals have shelter. You know what I mean? Like they live in caves. Like now, as a human being, you are devoid of that. It is becoming harder and harder to maintain a job or to even find a job in general, okay? And you ultimately reach the last stage of homelessness where it's the most visible homeless people that we see. People in tattered clothes running around, very clearly haven't taken a shower in fucking years. People who have lost their minds pretty much. And the further you move down those tiers, the harder it gets for recovery. Okay? Rehabilitation and recovery becomes infinitely harder at that stage. When I talk about housing or housing first or more affordable housing inventory, I'm talking about a multi-pronged approach that tries to eliminate the tier three homeless people that are invisibly homeless, okay? Because so many of those people get to that point before they reach a point of no return. They get to that point as a consequence of, and the overwhelming majority of them get to that point as a consequence of not drugs, not mental health issues, although that could be a factor in some of these instances. But they get to that point because they are priced out of their housing. That's it. And the only way to tackle that is by increasing the availability of affordable housing, okay? And sure, that will probably ruin property values. But God damn it, it's significantly, in the short term, it might ruin property values, certainly. But that is significantly better than having people living on the fucking streets eating trash as you have to look aside, as you have to look the other direction. And that's the most empathetic thing you can do. Okay? Nobody wants a dude who fucking jerks off in the middle of the goddamn street. Like, coming up to his fucking house and knocking on his door while cranking their fucking hog, okay? I don't want that. My mom lives with me. I don't want that shit. Let's be fucking real. Like, I'm not a psycho. I'm not going to sit here and act like, no, I love that. That's perfectly fine. Okay? Shut the fuck up, chatters. That seems specific? Yeah, it is specific. It's specific because it's fucking real. It's real. It happened. It's my life, okay? It's a real thing. The city of Vienna put out a video I watched on my stream. It shows exactly how to run a housing market. Yeah, we've already watched this. Oh, maybe not the city of Vienna's own version of this, but we've watched so many affordable housing videos about Red Vienna here. And in the long term, yes, having comprehensive supporting housing services in your area reduces crime and increases property values. That is the other part of it. But capitalism is so capitalism breaks people's brains into thinking only in short-term profits. So because of that reason, they don't even they can't think about it in any other way. They're like, short-term profit only, short-term profit only. Like, no, you'll get better fucking returns. You'll have a better society overall, a healthier society overall, and also better returns on your fucking investment down the line. As long as you shut the fuck up and wait 5 to 10 years instead of try to flip your goddamn house in 2, okay? That's the problem. But motherfuckers are thinking in 1 year terms, okay? They're thinking in quarterly dividends. They're not thinking about a better future. That is capitalist thinking. Profits now, profits now, profits now. Holy shit. If there's more availability in housing, if there are more social safety nets as a consequence of higher taxes, that's more money out of my fucking pocket right now. Not thinking about what that means. Cleaner streets, safer streets, a safer environment overall for everyone, including the homeless people and yourself and your children. I was furloughed from my job for 2 months and I was just brought back. The amount of debt I accumulated in just that amount of time and lack of support from the state of Texas, I would definitely be on the streets with almost impossible chance to get back on my feet had my girlfriend not let me move in with her. Exactly. Shut the fuck up and get to the damn news, you fucking dunce. Don't think that you understand the problems of the typical Norman. Don't speak about this like you know what it's truly like to struggle for shelter, who don't know where the next bite of food is coming from while having a fucking drug addiction stop. Your approach to this shit is so sideways, dog. I'm so sorry that your individual experience has not been entirely pleasant. Please tell me more about the homeless guy jagging in front of your multi-million dollar mansion. Okay, bro. I'm gonna be honest with you. I don't know if you're homeless or not right now, but like, I'm going to keep it $150. You're mentally ill, okay? So I hope you get the fucking treatment that you deserve. Like, if you just listen to me rant about how to fucking combat homelessness and you literally misunderstood every point that I just made, then your mental illness is unmanageable, okay? You are just literally going through a schizophrenic attack, I think. And it is manifesting by you watching me. earlier today. It's pretty appalling how you rarely take a break from the news, though. It's got to be unhealthy at a certain point, right? Yeah, it's probably unhealthy for you, actually, Carlos, to watch me like this. Jesus fucking Christ. Anyway. As the downtown loop in Kansas City turns 50 this year, let's not forget how it turned a vibrant neighborhood into a parking lot. Yellow shows surface parking lots while green are garages. Holy fuck. I don't think people understand, like, the shit that I'm talking about. Most people at my fucking level of finances are talking about in the exact opposite direction. And those people have a lot of fucking power united, okay? They're constantly united. For me, I'm not saying that, like, it's the worst thing on the fucking planet that a homeless person is jerking off outside of my house. I'm talking about how it is first and foremost a matter of safety for that person, okay? That person does not have shelter. I described the steps that that person probably went through to get to this fucking horrifying condition, okay? And now I'm talking about the other side of it and how that impacts everyday fucking citizens as well, not just myself. It is so psychotic to just misunderstand every point that I just made and think I'm making the opposite fucking point because of so much anger in your heart, so much resentment that you feel towards me. What the fuck's wrong with you? Did you call the cops? Did you help the homeless guy get the help he needed? No, man, I didn't fucking call the cops. What are you, crazy? No, of course not. No, he just went away. He just knocks on my door and then he fucks off. But like, I'm not a fucking social services person. Are you fucking stupid? This is what I think is like insane. Like the expectation is like every fucking person, no matter what they're doing, no matter what they're going through, no matter what their job is, needs to fucking drop everything and become a social services worker for that fucking moment when someone is doing a sexual assault, dude. What the fuck kind of psychotic expectation is that? We have a society for a fucking reason. You brain dead, Connecticut McMansion living cocksucking motherfuckers do not understand this. It's like, bro. Like, I don't get it. The trash, just pick it up yourself and take it to the dump yourself. No, dog. That's why we pay taxes. That's why there's a society. That's why people that work in sanitation should be paid adequately so they do this profoundly important fucking job. I hate how hyper-individualistic, you dumb, non-capital-owning, Honda Civic beater-driving, poor, broke fucks are talking like you own a fucking factory. You own no capital. You are fucking broke. And yet you talk like you're the monopoly man. You're so hyper individualistic and you don't recognize that that attitude is how you get fucked. That attitude is why we have societal collapse. The reason why all people... It's so dumb. That's the reason why our roads are broken, idiot. Because you as an individual can't fill the fucking potholes. Someone needs to pay for it. We all need to get together and pay for it. We have to pay for the labor. We have to pay for the fucking commodities that go into it. And a government's sole purpose is to make that collective action happen. But you're so fucking stupid. And you don't see that. And it makes me so angry. Because you're also not rich. You're broke. And you're not going to be rich. And you shouldn't have to either. You should not have to be wealthy to live a life of dignity. That's the point. And it makes me so mad. I didn't see it that way. I do understand when the situation arises, it can be challenging when this appears at your doorstep. And the funding we pay in taxes is diverted of interest capitalist volleyball courts. You are relatable, and it's easy for those who criticize you to think they could be you and do what you do, but they don't. I asked 5 years ago about a human centipede emoji, and will pretty face go to hell the other day? What? Just because you think you could do something doesn't mean you could do so- you should do something? What? Okay, I don't know what the fuck that was. Look, you say homelessness is my biggest blind spot as a leftist, I think. I've never called the cops or anything, and I'm mostly as kind as I can be, but I very rarely help. I definitely am pro everything you've been talking about and approve of the things on a macro level. I just don't ever take individual steps in my own life to help folks. Dude, you shouldn't have to. Homeless people should not exist. It's a societal fucking breakdown happening in front of our eyes. That's the point. There is an argument for socialism from a selfish perspective as well, okay? That's the point. Not everyone is capable of doing it. Not everyone is willing to do it. Not everyone is even good at being a social worker. That is the reason why we have social workers. They're profoundly empathetic individuals who do an incredible job. That's why we have division of labor, okay? It blows my mind that everyone is literally like, nah, dude, like, It almost goes back to that same like fat shaming entitled attitude that we were talking about yesterday, where people present themselves a certain way that they are not, okay? People on the internet will be like, what? You don't open your home to every homeless person on the street? That's fucking fuck you. It's like, bitch, you never did that. And you shouldn't have to. That's the point. We have a structure that is faulty, that happens in the first place, that there is a need for that in the first place. A need for philanthropy, a need for charity indicates systemic failure. That shouldn't stop you from working with philanthropies, as I do all the fucking time, but I am very aware that need for it is precisely the fault of systemic failure. If capitalism fucking worked, you wouldn't have charity. You wouldn't have need for charity. Anarchists are weirdly individualist. I know. They're American. Most Americans are just like impossible to fucking deal with. American individualism is just such a fucking cancerous attitude that they have. They don't want to think about it. They don't want to think about it from the perspective of a collectivist attitude. They don't want to think about like collective action. They don't want to think about systemic solutions. It's impossible for them to envision a future where any of that happens. And that's how we arrive at this at the reinforcement of these same fucking structural problems over and over again. People aren't homeless due to people not buying them sandwiches or taking them in. They're homeless because the way our society works is broken. Individual action isn't adequate because the problem is systemic. Yes. anarchists are extremely collective. What the fuck are you talking about? No, he's talking about like brain broken American anarchists who are literally like, dude, what the fuck are you doing? You should drop everything and like dedicate your life to becoming a social worker instead.
Gentleman named Q lives. I spoke to him. He's quite happy to be here, but says he's planning to move soon. So this is the situation in 2022 in Los Angeles. You can basically build your own small wooden house right on Hollywood Boulevard, live in it, continue to refuse offers of city services, and most people around here are okay with it. Others say it has to go. It's a solid.
He literally mentioned most people are okay with it. Yeah, this is infinitely better than fucking living inside of a tent. Okay, this dude's hurting nobody. It's kind of nice. Good for him. You know what I mean? He's like combating the elements. Great. Yeah, like what? You want trash everywhere? You shouldn't even have to live like this. Like he shouldn't have to live like this. You should live in a fucking home. Okay, you should be able to live in a in actual shelter, permanent shelter. Would you be okay with that outside of your house? Hey, dumb motherfucker, I live in West Hollywood, okay? It's infinitely worse outside my house. This is like fucking one zip code down from me, you fucking idiot. Shut the fuck up. You live in Arkansas. You don't know anything about homeless people. Dumb motherfuckers who are like 14 living literally in Arkansas talking shit. Oh my God, I'm gonna lose my fucking mind. I've had 4 Molotov cocktail tent burnings happen outside of my fucking house. 4! Shut the fuck up! People are so stupid. You think these you think this is normal? It's not. Obviously not in the same week. Well, 2 of them were in the same week, but. People are terrified of cities. People are literally terrified of cities. They'll never live in a city. And then they try to tell a fucking city boy like me what it's like. Bro, they're cutting this news coverage like basically in my fucking backyard. What are you telling me? What are you talking about? Remember when the shit was happening, when the like organized retail theft was happening, and I was telling you guys, or the follow home robberies were happening, and I was like, guys, These are greatly overblown. And motherfuckers would be like, you don't understand, bro. I was like, what are you talking about? They're talking about my neighborhood. Like, why are you living in a Connecticut McMansion in the fucking suburbs telling me about what is going on apparently in my fucking backyard? You think you know better than me? Yeah, these are the motherfuckers in my chat. Conservative guy scared of cities. Saw that thing on the news. Too many of those people there. Can't park Ford Super Duty. Not scared, bro. Didn't that happen when that one dude stole your merch and then returned it? Yeah, it did happen. What you're saying and 100% real. What is this? Oh, yeah, it is. The funniest part about it is like when I say stuff like we need to deal with homelessness by having a housing first policy that will in the short term potentially lower the housing values in a particular marketplace, right? But ultimately will yield such positive, profoundly positive impacts. And people will be like, oh, nah, dog, you just don't want tent cities outside your house. Like, that's a fucking own, dude. Yeah, I don't. I literally don't. Do you? No. Why is that, like, somehow indecent? I don't want that because I don't want anyone to live in that situation. I don't want that because I also don't want to live in that situation either. Like, I don't get it. It's like, you make it seem like it's indecent because I'm self-interested. Like, yeah, I am. I am self-interested. I don't want people, one, first and foremost, I don't want people living in fucking tents and eating trash, okay? I don't. But two, I also don't want people living in a tent and jerking off outside my fucking house. My mom is living with me. Yeah, I don't want that. I'm scared. I don't want that. Is that psychotic? No, I don't think so. It's just being a normal human being. That doesn't stop me from living where I want to live, obviously. I'm not one of these fucking freaks who's like, I'm moving into the suburbs, brother. Shit's going crazy out here. No, like, I understand. I grew up in cities my entire life, okay? When you live in a fucking big city, there's going to be crime. When you live in a big city, there's going to be homeless people. I wish that there wasn't, okay? And I know how to solve it, but we're never going to solve it. But that's not going to deter me from fucking living in a city. Because I'm not a pussy. Okay. Motherfuckers be like, nah, dude, I'm such a good leftist. I want, you know, mentally ill people jerking off outside my house, actually. That's the best way to showcase how leftist you are, dog. By saying shit that you don't fucking believe in. That's how you become the best leftist. You say it on Twitter, okay? And then you get all the leftist brownie points. You're like, I'm the most leftist, dog. Like, I would let the homeless person jerk off in my mouth, actually. What the fuck? You should be catching those cummies with your mouth. That's what I would do. I'm the best, dude. The fucking best, dog. It's like, meanwhile, you literally live in, like, some fucking wealthy white suburb in Idaho, and you're just saying that. You're just saying that on Twitter. And the reason why you live there is because your mom and dad are terrified of the fucking city life, okay? And you've never experienced it yourself, so you're just fucking tweeting about it. I'm not gonna sit here and lie to you and act like I don't have a personal, a personal vested interest in this. Everyone does, though, okay? It's a win-win for everyone. I'm using the individualist argument for those who have no empathy in their fucking hearts.
Well-built wooden structure. Propped up by metal carts and car batteries. A power cord unplugged trails down the sidewalk, which is piled high with assorted power tools and electronics. Reaction? Mixed. What do you think of that?
I don't like it. It's not good. It's bad.
It is a little out there, but he is safe and he doesn't have to worry about someone burning his tent down.
I don't even know, like, why or how or, I mean, it's crazy.
That shit happens so frequently, by the way. More frequently than the top of the hour ad break, which comes at the top of the hour. I forgot to run it at the top of the hour last time, so I'm running it right now. At the top of the hour, there's a 6-second ad break. If you no longer want to see those ads, all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or for free. Okay. You can also get gifted a sub. Here's the 1-minute ad break now. Look. The reason why he brought up fucking no one can burn his tent down is because that shit happens so frequently, by the way. That's another thing. It's like, there are tent fires more than once an hour, lol. No, dude, not one more than once an hour, but it does. Those certainly happen a lot. That's the other side of being homeless. On top of not having fucking shelter, there's sexual assaults that occur, okay? Especially inside of shelters where it happens more frequently than outside of shelters almost, okay? There's also like, you know, theft happening within the homeless community, okay? You get your shit stolen. You get your tents burned. I used to be a manager of the Walmart in Southgate, and the homeless camp behind our store caught on fire once a week at least. Yeah. You think there's inter-community bullying and bullies? Yeah, bro. Also, there's, you know, drug deals too. Like, there is, you know, there's a little bit of that. There's cooking. But, like, I have seen, like, I'm telling you, there's also, you know, violence that breaks out regularly.
It's crazy, to say the least. Is this okay?
It's not okay that it's gotten to this point. The fact that he's here, I don't see an issue with it.
Anybody home?
After I call the city and the LAPD to see what, if anything, is being done to help or clean up.
What the fuck? Dude, what is wrong with this motherfucker, bro? What are you doing? The dude's trying to live, man. What the fuck?
Police did come and talk to the man. They've been here before. They described him as young, healthy. They offered to connect him with services. He declined. They left. Summing up the municipal code, the only enforcement is if a person is blocking the sidewalk or an active driveway or business. City Councilman Mitch O'Farrell says he hopes this can be resolved with what are called Care Plus teams, which pair comprehensive outreach with sanitation and cleaning services needed to make the public right-of-way safe and accessible.
I think it's pretty funny that we care about walkability on our sidewalks when it comes to homeless people, but like there are so many areas where there are just no sidewalks or sidewalks are in a state of fucking disrepair. Pretty cool that like the only time they care about, you know, walkability is when they can fucking kill homeless people. Awesome. Love that. Ironic, because if they did genuinely care about walkability and had adequate public transit, that would lead to less homeless people, because ease of access to a fucking job without having a fucking car allows you to, you know, be able to live further away in a cheaper house. And still maintain your fucking profession, your job. Less likely to fucking lose your house all of a sudden. But, you know, it's all built. It's all interwoven. The entire system is built on this fucking weird contradiction. So, when those contradictions become more apparent, you see more of these issues prop up left and right. If every homeless person had the desire to get a job, yeah, this kind of rhetoric is so fucking funny, man. Yeah, dude, it's because homeless people are like, man, I hate jobs. That's why I want to be homeless. Yeah, dude, yeah, totally. Also, you're watching Twitch at 1:19 p.m. You either are in a comfortable job where you can do a work from home bullshit fucking thing because you have upper middle class family members that literally allowed you to be able to go to a fucking state college or something like that. And then you got a fucking nepotism hire job somewhere and you can do a work from home thing where you're literally fake fucking typing on your computer as you're watching me, or you're jobless, okay? And your parents are keeping you afloat, and you're simultaneously talking shit on people saying, oh man, these guys are homeless because they don't want to work, am I right? Like, that's not how this works. Okay? We are all profoundly privileged in comparison to fucking homeless people that are suffering in the streets. God damn it, dude. There's nothing wrong with the things I just mentioned, by the way. But there is something wrong with fucking acting like homeless people are you know, would be in a better situation overall. They just can't fucking bootstrap themselves out of that.
Meantime, across the street, where Jamila Ali and Rant Shaw run City Vibes Coffee, compassion is still on the menu.
He hasn't like bothered anyone, and honestly I'm glad that it's right there, because I honestly feel safer with him there for some reason. I don't know why. It's just he feels like, it feels like he's like, he knows what he's doing and he's not here to like hurt anyone.
Unfortunately, they have to make us a little bit uncomfortable for them to be comfortable, and I think that's just like the problem in LA. No one realizes.
That's the funniest part, is that like that is the most empathetic liberal take, is just like, yeah, we just got to be a little uncomfortable. It's like, no, man. No, you don't have to, actually. There is a better future. That, and these people are very empathetic. And, you know, these are not bad people, okay? These are good people. These are kind people. The reality, of course, is that, like, They are still kind within the boundaries of capitalism, within the confines of capitalism for most people. So they just think like, oh, we should be like cohabitating this space together. It's like, no, that's not. That's not. No, they should not have to live outdoors. I promise. That's a thing. They should not have to live outdoors. They should live indoors in a house in permanent shelter. Not a homeless shelter, permanent residence, permanent shelter.
Realizes how much of a burden it can do to like our mentality, yeah, and just the way we carry ourselves.
Q tells me he's from Kansas City. He's been in LA for about 3 years, been here for a few months. He says he's self-employed. He fixes bike.
Who's paying for the permanent shelter? Not you, sons of Samadhi. Me, motherfucker, me. Rich people like me. Okay, how about that? Is that better for you? Not you. Says you with a $2 billion house? Exactly. Troll face. Like, that's the thing. Like, I already pay for it. I just want to see some returns, man. If we're going to think about the government as a business, I want to see a return on my investment. Why the fuck is all the dollars that I'm funding, the California state, going directly into the pockets of the fucking police department? Let's fix some goddamn potholes and let's put some fucking permanent shelter out there. What the fuck is that about? I have a right to be mad. I have a right to be angry.
He wants to be a mechanical engineer and that he is an Army veteran. Saturday, Alex and Marla, the city tells me they're planning to clean this all up as part of this Care Plus program.
They're called sweeps. That's what it is. They make it seem like they're doing something that's good when they're not doing something that's good. They're just fucking destroying someone's, like, shelter, pretty much.
It's had great success here in Hollywood. If you've been to the underpass and Gower on the 101 freeway, all cleaned up. So
just like
it's
going
to be interesting
what?
To see what, if anything, happens to this man. As I mentioned, he's perfectly happy being here, and most of the people around here are happy to have him. Live in Hollywood, I'm Phil Schumann.
You know, that, first up, how is he not blocking the sidewalk? And secondly, you know, is it, Alex! You know, it looks like a structure there, and these are, the business owners there have to spend a lot of money in taxes, have to go through permitting processes.
Come on, Alex, like, these are, like, otherwise kind individuals, but, like, the moment you fucking see homeless people, they just, like, lose their minds, bro, I swear to God. Like, that's not good, okay? That is better than, like, tent cities, okay? But that's still not good. That is inadequate shelter, okay? Yes, I do know Alex. I do know him. I've been on a show multiple times. I've debated literally this issue in Los Angeles against Larry Elder, who ran for fucking governor. But liberals in California have lost their fucking goddamn minds. I've been telling you guys this for a year plus. I can't change people's attitudes, especially rich people's attitudes, okay? I try, but I can't. They just don't want to hear it. They think I'm seeing the problem right in front of my eyes and something needs to fucking change. And that is, I fear that that is a descent into way more reactionary policy provisions. Way more reactionary policy proposals.
Does everybody around there that lives there have to pay property taxes?
Yeah.
Does he pay any property taxes?
Q, we're on live on Fox 11. Alex, so well, nobody's saying this is a great idea. Hey, we're on live. Thanks for talking with us. What are you doing here, and how did this come to be?
Well, I was originally in a tent, and when the sanitation comes, you know, once every 2 weeks, they have you take the tent down and clear all your stuff out.
Yeah.
And so what I had an idea just to build something on wheels so that way I wouldn't have to
show us what you got here.
Well,
I mean, where did you get all the material and everything?
Well, I got most of the material from like a construction site that threw away old wood.
Yeah.
And then some friends of mine that had some wood left.
No, they mentioned that he's an Army veteran, by the way. Yeah, this is a veteran. By the way, remember, we love our vets. We love our vets, dude. Oh my God, we love our vets. We want to suck and fuck our vets. Except when they're homeless, then they're scum, right? Remember, they only think about homeless veterans when it comes to like shitting on undocumented immigrants that are coming into the country. Remember that, okay? Are they paying property taxes? No, they're not paying. That's not a property. Of course there's no property tax. Shut the fuck up. Dude, this man's net worth is like $3. And you're like, is he paying property taxes? For what, dude? As a first-generation Flexican American who was homeless as a kid for a little bit, living in a car homeless, as a child thought of it as camping, my older brothers and parents must have been so scared at night. In the 90s, when the commercial real estate market in Texas took a shit, my father lost his job. He worked construction. Like, how was he or my family lazy? Fucking weird chatters who can't muster any empathy. Exactly. These people are not lazy. Look at this guy. This dude is a fucking industrious person, okay? Look at him. He has made so much with so little. Given the adequate opportunities, given actual housing, that dude is crushing it, okay? That dude is turning his life around. But society does not offer that to him. Look at the way that they behave. Look at the way that they're fucking even, you know, this is a telegenic homeless person, right? He's a vet. He very clearly can work with his hands. He can work construction. Motherfuckers, though, look at him and go, oh, he's lazy. He built a fucking rust base, bro, on a corner on Hollywood Boulevard. Very clearly, if circumstances weren't dire, he'd be fine. And even in the most telegenic circumstance, when you see a homeless person, your empathy part of your brain just shuts off immediately. And you're like, well, why isn't he paying for property taxes? Oh, what's going on?
Over, and then there was a shop across the street that had some old flooring.
You have electricity in there?
Yeah, I've got a generator over here.
So you've been offered housing, temporary housing from the city and other agencies?
Right.
But yeah. you prefer this, or?
Well, I kind of do prefer this because it kind of gives me empowerment. A lot of the housing, a lot of the housing programs they offer, they put you in like a, what seems like a concentration camp. And
so this is more.
He's right, by the way, straight up. Homeless shelters are so inadequate, dude. One, as a lack of adequate funding, but like, he's right. Homeless shelters are unsafe. One, you can't take your shit with you. If you have an animal, you can't take your animal with you. You can't take your shit with you. They're constantly fucking putting you under drug tests. If you're like, you can't go cold turkey if you're addicted to something. I'm not saying he is, but that's one of the many reasons why people don't want to do it. And lastly, and perhaps the most important reason, it's unsafe. It is deeply unsafe. There's a lot of sexual assault that occurs. There's a lot of property theft that occurs inside of these shelters. There's a lot of fighting that happens. Okay? What they need is not shelters. What they need is not a concentration camp style temporary shelter. What they need is permanent shelter, a home. That is at the heart of. Not true about animals and drug tests. Wait, what? You're wrong about that, I think. Or maybe you're thinking about your own personal homeless shelter that you worked at or something. Shelters literally operate like a lot of shelters, especially in big cities, operate like institutionalized, like, you know, criminal centers, basically. Every homeless person I've talked to and every social worker I've talked to that works with homeless people talk about precisely animals and drug tests as like some of the primary reasons as to why shelters are not sustainable on top of sexual assault and other forms of violence that occurs regularly. I was in a youth homeless shelter. My shit always got stolen. Fights 24/7. He's right. Chatter, shut the fuck up. So basically, get off your ass and stop being a homeless loser. Yeah, dude. Instead, you know, get on your ass and watch fucking Twitch.tv and talk shit like a fucking idiot. So you think shelters had no restrictions to them? All the issues you said about the dangers of it would disappear? Fuck no, dude. Because shelters are temporary. These people don't need temporary housing. They need permanent housing. Holy shit.
They out here saying, okay, get a job. Get a job. Go get a job. Okay, how? Explain to me how. I go into a shelter, 90% of all the shelters, you have a person off in the corner smoking a boogie and the staff member not doing nothing about it. You have other people while you're sleeping stealing your stuff. You have staff members sexually assaulting females inside the facilities. So most of them rather sleep outside in the danger and the cold than actually be in there, because when the reason why they left them or out on the street in the first place is because their mom or their dad or their brother or their uncle or someone in their family was either mentally, emotionally, physically, or sexually abusive. So they're out here just because they'd rather not be in that environment. That's why you got so young kids out here. They out here.
Temporary housing would have to last for years for each of these people, let alone be decent to live in, for those living there to be, have a chance to get their own home. Yeah. Awful Poet says, kick you out 5 a.m. to 5 p.m., required religious indoctrination, can't stay with your spouse, no pets, only a bag for personal property, all stolen, extensive violence, one meal at night. This only describes short-term housing. Long-term housing, no record of any kind, limited family availability, enormous waiting lists, source years homeless with and without a spouse. Yeah. For the record, like I said, most jobs require that you have a home address. Exactly. Most jobs require you to shower and be able to clean your fucking clothes. Can't do that shit. That's why I get so goddamn triggered whenever I fucking see those YouTube videos of people being like, oh, I was homeless. And you know, here's how I capitalismed my way out of having one penny to my name. This shit's not a joke. It's not. It's just, it's so fucked up. Anyway, I mean, we know how people feel about homeless people. Reactionary people don't even fucking hide their disdain. And even liberals are incredibly fucking reactionary towards homeless people because, you know, they see what I've talked about already. Like the most visible homeless people are often going to be the ones that need help the most desperate. A lot of mental illness, a lot of drug addiction. And that's what you see. So you fucking think like you have this reactionary attitude towards it. You think like everyone is there. And then when your starting point is like this hyper-capitalistic, super individualist attitude, you think like these people are there because of their own failures, because we think poverty is a moral failure. And a lot of us, especially neets, especially people that are fortunate enough to be in this Twitch community, or in any community on Twitch for the most part, have never had to experience that personally. I have never had to experience that personally. Let's be real. I've never been homeless. I've had the fear of losing housing, for sure. And it's a terrifying prospect. I had to live in a fucking kitchen of a frat house. But I've never been homeless. I've always been able to figure shit out. But until you live in that situation, like, you're never going to understand it, okay? But that was still permanent shelter, chat. That was a permanent shelter still, okay?
My truth with being homeless, kind of complicated, but it's pretty much, it's not the same. But I'll tell you one truth. Being homeless is because of the economy, inflation.
I got to pee, I'll be back.
So I choose to stay on the streets, it's easier. The money lasts that way. It's embarrassing, but you have to live in society in a way that is given to you rather than going against it or breaking it. So I am looking for housing. I do not have a drug problem or alcohol problem. Rent is just high and it's strictly unaffordable for me. And that's probably the main reason why I'm homeless. I have spent 6 years in the military when I was young. I got other than honorable discharge, so that kind of limits me from my benefits from the military. I've pretty much been in Los Angeles all my life. I recently went to Arizona for a while, and I come back. Arizona is very expensive and hot. But I'm comfortable here because I know the land, I know the area. So if you're gonna be homeless, basically homeless, you know, where you know somebody and know places. So that's pretty much why I'm back in Los Angeles. I have a brother that doesn't care about me. My mother's dead, my father's dead, my aunties are dead. I have absolutely no one. And that's less worries, less stress. It hurts, only around holidays. But outside of that, it's not that bad. I am not competitive. Trust me, I'm humble. Nails like these will humble me. I am pretty humble. I appreciate you talking to me. At least I know that the world cares or you care. And that's pretty much made my day. If you see somebody in my situation, don't frown upon them. The best thing you can do is look at them and learn from them. Don't be afraid to ask them something because they're actually helping you not to be in that situation. So you can always learn from somebody. Whether you agree with it or not, or look at it as a negative or a positive, you still can learn. And I don't want anybody to learn from me so they don't end up like me. And you've been awesome for giving me a sandwich this morning. Cool. Appreciate that. I haven't given up. This is not giving up. This is called doing what you got to do, given the circumstances. It'll get better. I know it's going to get better.
And unfortunately, there is very little coverage on homeless people as human beings, like the one you just saw. And the coverage is more so like this, antagonistic. That's what you see in local news. That's what you see in national news. And that's what your experience is if you're like terrified of people living in tents, especially when you see someone like the only type of homeless person that you see is one that is like very clearly going through like a mental outbreak or a mental breakdown in public. So then your attitude is like, paired up with your capitalist understanding of like, of poverty being bred out of some kind of moral failing, you think like, oh, these people fucked up and they deserve to be in this situation and they're crazy and they're scary and I don't want to be around them. So you never actually think about policies that would help them. You never actually think about how this could happen to you. You never actually think about how this could happen to you or a loved one. When in fact, this is incredibly commonplace, okay? And it's getting even more commonplace. It's becoming more and more common. Why? And we're going to talk about the grandma who was arrested for feeding people in need in a second. This was an insane story, okay? It's happening because how the housing market is insane. $40 of Americans don't have $400 additional dollars in emergency spending. 40% of Americans. That's one fucking trip to the hospital away from homelessness, and you're over here thinking like, you know, that you're fine, and all your friends and all your family members are fine. They're not. It's let's finish this
or
video.
Or this is freedom for you.
Yes, yeah, it's feel more freedom.
You got plants?
Yeah.
You got tapestry?
Yeah, I feel like I have more of a way to express my, you know, artist nature and everything.
But Q, I mean, you have to understand that a lot of people don't think this belongs here. I mean, this is a public street.
Yeah.
You know, there are better options for you.
Yeah. Yeah, there's probably a better places, you know, than this. But I mean, I don't think that I'm bothering anyone here, you know. This business isn't even in, you know.
Yeah, it's an empty building.
So is he taking the power from the city?
I try to keep the...
Because he doesn't get a power bill.
Clean and, you know, I sell bikes and I make, you know, motorbikes and electric scooters and stuff like that. I've fixed several people that live in the neighborhood. I fixed their scooters and stuff like that. So...
Are you happy?
Yeah, I feel good, man. You know, I feel good. I feel like I'm, you know, kind of...
Like, that lady is fucking insane. She's stealing power from the city. It's like, bro, this person has been fucked, okay? This person has been completely fucked by society. And even in that circumstance, you're like, well, what about the fairness? I have to pay for my bill. Like, how can you be such a bloodthirsty freak? I don't understand it. This is legitimately something that I do not understand. You look at a man who has tried to make the most of his circumstances, and you feel anger. Not towards the system that has put him there, but you feel anger because he's been able to overcome at least some of the horrifying, destitute situation that he's been presented with. You feel angry. You're like, well, what about the injustice? What about me? Me. I have to pay for my electricity. Why is he not paying for his? That's fucking psychotic, dude. You are not a good person. You're a fucking bad person. I know he said he had a generator, but it doesn't matter. Even if he didn't have a fucking generator, even if he was stealing power from one of the businesses or stealing power from the city, who gives a fuck? He's literally, like, the alternative is this guy dies, okay?
Being an example for people that's in my situation, letting them know that, you know, just because you are living on the streets doesn't mean that you have to just let go, give everything up, you know.
Where do you get food and use the bathroom and stuff?
Well, I go to local stores and, you know, while I'm out.
Let's walk this way, yeah.
Hey,
yeah,
Phil.
While I'm out and out.
Yeah, I'm listening.
While I'm out and about, I use the restroom at, you know, different stores and stuff like that. But
go ahead, Marla.
I'm just curious about, but, you know, he has the generator and the power cord that you showed.
You
he doesn't get a bill, so is he just milking it from the city?
You know, I sell bikes and...
He's not connected to the city. No, this is a generator with... can we peek inside or no?
Okay.
I'd rather not, man. Yeah, because I don't have it cleaned up and then it's not finished. So
people around here seem to like you.
Yeah.
You're a super friendly guy.
Yeah.
But there's other people that are watching this saying this is ridiculous.
Right. Well, I mean, I don't know, you know, where they're coming from, you know, or why they believe what they believe, but, you know, there was a fire.
Even the guy who, like, originally came in with the intention of, like, you know, cutting fucking anti-homeless propaganda is like, shut the fuck up, bitch. Okay? No, he's not stealing power from the city. Like, even he was like, shut up. Like, calm the fuck down, okay? You fucking bloodthirsty freak. You monster. You demon of a human. Holy fuck! By the way, remember, this is a telegenic person, okay? Marginalized people do not have to be telegenic. They do not have to make the best victim, the perfect victim for you to understand the plight that they're going through. This is a person who is good on camera and you know, well-kept despite the circumstances that he's been dealing with his entire fucking life, okay? And even in that situation, she's still like, no, how do we murder him? I I thought you were being hyperbolic when you said someone will run on turning homeless people into biomatter. I actually think that's serious, seeing these people's reactions. Yes, of course, dude. Jesus.
Around the corner right here, one of the guys' tents caught on fire. And so, you know, that probably puts a nasty stain on it.
Well, thank you for talking with us and sharing some of your story. Go ahead, Marla.
Phil, my last question is, you said he was going to move soon. Yeah. So does he literally roll it somewhere else? Where is he moving to?
Yeah, you were talking about moving and just like rolling this down the sidewalk? Or?
Yeah, I've got some dollies I'm going to put underneath and move it from out in front of the fence. I got to have this thing moved by tomorrow or the police said they're going to take me to jail. So I got to move. So that's why all my stuff's outside right now.
So if an agency came to you and said, Q, we got an apartment for you in Hollywood, indoors, services, job training, health benefits, would you take it?
Well, I want to start my own business, but as far as the apartment situation, I don't know where I'm going to be able to store all my stuff. And then I do a lot of grinding and welding and stuff like that. So, I mean, I don't know. Maybe that's not the best
solution for you.
Yeah, because my generators and my, you know, I kind of like that lifestyle. Anyway,
all right,
though.
Alex, Marla, slice of life.
Ugh, at the end, they have to make it seem like, first of all, they don't offer that, okay? But he's presenting an adequate problem. This is a person who has skill. This is a person who has power tools, who knows how to use those power tools. In an adequate society, they would not only offer him housing, but he would be able to use those tools in the way that he wants to and build his own fucking business and survive off of it.
Fair on the streets of Hollywood. We'll send it back to you.
He's resourceful.
That's fascinating, Phil. Yeah. Thank you.
How does this get fixed? Housing.
All right, San Diegans are frustrated and horrified at our growing homeless population, but it's not just us.
Yeah, people are finding themselves homeless across the entire state, and experts say it'll take years to get better. CBS 8...
Bro, look at that. Look at that. You think that shit's normal, dog? Wealthiest nation on the planet? California as a state is like the fourth largest economy. It's slated to become like the fourth largest economy on the planet, okay? We're about to pass Germany, motherfucker. This is craziness. Do you understand? This is craziness, bro. That shit's crazy. Capitalism. Motherfuckers will say liberal policies did this. I'm like, yeah, you're right. Liberal capitalist policies have done this. Okay? That's the point. That's the problem. Boyle Heights residents protest proposal to turn Sears building into homeless housing. Yeah, that shit sucks. I hate when people are like, we don't want this. It's disrespectful. They have no respect for us. Yeah, there you go. And the media will run with people that are fucking going off. The media will run with people going off on homeless people, like, because they're all local news is so right wing.
Use it as a bathroom. In the morning when the business owners come to open up, they have to try to deal with a homeless person literally blocking entrance to their business. And
bro, I mean, that's, you know, I can't believe you just filmed that and like put it on the fucking video there. Dude was taking a shit. Yeah, I know, man. Welcome to fucking living in a city, by the way, for the record. It is so dehumanizing to fucking film that. But also, it's 100% a thing that happens. For all you suburb bandies out here who don't recognize that, like, no, that is definitely something that happens regularly, okay? You know why it happens? Because he doesn't have shelter. Where is he going to shit? How is he going to clean himself? He doesn't have shelter. That's it. What are you supposed to do? You can't use the bathrooms in stores. No public restrooms, okay? No social safety net. What do you do? And also, he is the final tier of homelessness. Like, it's obvious.
Then they have to deal with cleaning up hazardous waste right in front of their business, right in Sherman Oaks, right on Ventura Boulevard.
It's mostly the criminal aspect of the homeless and unhoused.
Theo Mavro is the owner of The Sherman, a restaurant bar. He says customers enjoying their meals are...
Oh, I've actually been there. I went on a date there one time many, many years ago. Holy shit. Didn't realize it was owned by that fucking guy.
Constantly harassed.
Literally come by and just grab something and carry on. That happens all the time.
And even more disturbing is the violence. Theo's host was recently involved in an incident.
So my manager had to step in the middle and get the person off of her. And he got hit, he got assaulted, and one of the guests got hit in the face. This happens.
While we were conducting interviews on Ventura Boulevard, we repeatedly offered to connect the unhoused with much-needed services. Do you need help?
Do you need help?
Eva, are you okay? Do you need any help? You're not interested in housing? No.
Oh, come on, dog. Are you fucking joking? Bro, what are you doing?
You're not interested in housing?
I mean, this is so aggro that it almost feels like it's like fake and made for like a comedy sketch to showcase how inhumane local news reporters are. You know what I mean? Except it's real and it's psychotic. Like YouTubers that do this shit, you'd be like, dog, that's way too far.
Okay, thank you, sir. Scrivano points to an obvious fact. Many unhoused people are in desperate need of mental health assistance. Scrivano says leaving them out on the streets like this is simply irresponsible, cruel, and dangerous for everyone. In your opinion, what's the solution?
The solution is that person who thinks he works for the FBI and who terrorizes my neighborhood is given the choice as to whether he wants housing or not.
Do you think that person wouldn't be in a situation where, like, that person needs mental health treatment immediately, okay? What the fuck? These people act like homeless, just love being homeless, have no desire to get home. Bro, that person has no autonomy, okay? His brain is fucking fried. If that was a relative of yours, you would help them out, okay? That's crazy. The solution is get him off the fucking street. That's crazy.
It's not a choice anymore. When people are suffering, you give them care. If they're really suffering, you pull them into care. Or you lose them.
These frustrated...
He's not wrong. He's just using, like, lib terms, so I misunderstood what he was saying, but he's right. Like, that person should not be on the fucking street. That person's brain has been fried. Are you against putting these people in mental health facilities without their consent? Bro, that person cannot consent, okay? If what he is saying is true, and there are plenty of people like that in the streets, that person is incapable of offering, like, informed consent. What are you talking about? That person does not have autonomy. He thinks he's a fucking FBI agent. And no, I'm not talking about Herschel Walker running for the fucking Senate seat, okay?
Business owners say they've repeatedly called police and city officials. They say their pleas for help have fallen on deaf ears.
There is anger in the community. It is palpable, and we want it addressed proactively, and we're going to do everything in our power to make sure that that happens, including leaning on any elected official.
LA City Councilwoman Nithya Raman represents the 4th District, which includes Sherman Oaks. Business owners say they have repeatedly called, emailed, and tagged her on social media posts. Scrivano sends her off as videos of the homeless making threats and going to the bathroom on Ventura Boulevard. Scrivano says he was told to stop sending such graphic material.
Nithya Raman does not care. She does not care.
The reality is that people who are experiencing homelessness are still individuals who are there on the streets because they don't have a home.
We caught up with Councilwoman Raman at a public event after fruitless attempts to set up an interview.
The business owners are tired of having someone block their business. Yes. How would you like it if somebody threw feces at you?
I mean, I obviously would not like it. And to anybody who's experiencing these issues, I have the deepest.
She's trying to do an ambush interview with Nithya Raman. And like her first point is like, what if someone threw caca at you? You're an unhinged psychopath, dude. You're literally an unhinged psychopath. You need to get help, okay? If that's your fucking take, you need to get fucking help, okay? How do we help these people is entirely different than, like, how do we melt the homeless? Is Nithya mid, though? No, she's actually done some pretty fucking decent work with tackling a gigantic issue as best as she can. From what I understand, obviously, like, you know, it's nearly impossible to fucking make changes as a singular council member, even though you have a profound amount of power. She's done a bunch of, not sweeps, but she has done a bunch of, like, long-term sustainable housing programs, like, where it takes a very long time to actually come to fruition. Because if you take an empathetic approach that centers homeless people and their plight, and you actually get social workers to go in and convince homeless people to leave their encampments, to go into, transitional housing and then sustainable housing, that is going to take a long time. Some people are not going to want to leave. You know, there's always going to be more issues that way. The other solution is to do sweeps immediately. Bring in the police, bring in sanitation, blow up the fucking encampments, clean them up, sweep it, force them elsewhere. Like, they have tents usually, so they're mobile, right? As mobile as you can get, I guess. Where they'll just, like, sweep one block and go, all right, fuck off, move on to the next city block until it becomes a problem again. Waiting on the crust punk weirdos to come in and take, like, well, if you end up homelessness, then you're ending homelessness culture, and that's tantamount to genocide? No, I don't think any crust punks have fucking chimed in on with a psychotic take like that. This is super serious. Even the trust fund crust punk anarchists are not chiming in with the I love being homeless, actually. Takes at this moment.
Of sympathies and empathy. This issue is a humanitarian crisis, and it's a crisis for the entire city of Los Angeles.
Raman says the only way to solve this crisis is to fix the problem that leads to homelessness. And that, she says, is lack of housing.
No matter how many times you move them from one location, they are still people who don't have homes, and so they're simply going to move down the street.
She's right. She's literally talking about how sweeps don't work. Sweeps are not adequate, long-term, sustainable solutions to homelessness because you're just pushing the problem away, okay? You're not tackling the problem. You're avoiding it. Just like many of you want to avoid the top of the hour ad break, because at the top of the hour, there's a six-second ad break, and if you no longer want to see those ads, well, then all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or you can do for free with a Twitch Prime. By connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account, you get one free Prime subscription a month. You can also get gifted a sub if you're lucky. Okay, not many are, but some are. Here's the 1 minute ad break now.
Pass
compassion? Where is the compassion in leaving someone on the street when they clearly cannot help themselves in any way?
And I don't believe that anyone who is suffering from mental illness should not be receiving the care that they deserve.
But with only one mental health outreach team in the San Fernando Valley funded by the county.
Seems like that's an issue, right? Seems like that's a viable business. Here, capitalist brain, if you want to think about it, that seems like there's a lot of job opportunity there to find compassionate individuals who will provide compassionate care to those who desperately need it. Seems like there's an opportunity to grow a fucking viable industry if you want to think about it from a capitalist point of view.
Too many people are staying exactly where they are without any help.
The rights of the homeless cannot exceed the rights of the homeowners and the business owners.
The rights of the homeless cannot exceed the rights of the homeowners. Brother, on what planet are you living on? Are you living in fucking Mars, dude? What rights do homeless people have, dog? They have none. They have no rights. They're living in the fucking streets. Shut the fuck up.
There has to be a balance between those two rights, and right now, that balance is tipping mightily.
Yeah, these motherfuckers are living on garbage, okay? They're literally living on a sustainable diet of eating garbage all day. And there's homies out here like, yeah, man, it's really fucked up how the homeless people have had it far too good for too long. You know what I mean? We got to stop this from happening.
In favor of the homeless to the detriment of the people that live here and work here. We're not insensitive to these issues, but it's gotten to the point where it's beyond control and something has got to give.
Councilman Rahman says that she's only been in office for a year and a half, and this problem has been around for many, many years. She says it cannot be solved with a magic wand. Alex,
nobody talks about the plight of big homeless, dude. I mean, nobody talks about big homeless, dude. It's crazy.
Christine?
Marla. Gina, specifically, as we move forward from your reporting, did she say specifically what she's going to be doing to help those who are unhoused right there, and then also to help the business owners in the meantime?
Well, she says that her staff goes out on the streets and they go and talk to people. They try to get them into some sort of shelter. But she also puts the blame on the county. She says the county is responsible for providing mental health assistance to the homeless. And as I said in the story, there's only one group out there in the San Fernando Valley, and that's just not enough.
I mean, they see it. They see, like, okay, there's prevention. There's short-term homelessness is a crisis born out of capitalism. So obviously it's multifaceted and a very complex problem to deal with. And tackling it, in tackling a crisis such as this, there are so many different avenues that you need to hit it from, okay? You have the short-term immediate help, right? What she's describing is, there's only one group of individuals that are dealing with, crisis centers. One group of individuals that are dealing with it. They are underfunded, and they don't have enough people or enough funds to go out and, like, do outreach. Okay? So that's number one. But then also, the long-term sustainable solutions revolve around fixing the housing crisis so that there aren't more homeless people that are, you know, becoming homeless. More people losing housing as a consequence of being priced out of the housing market. Okay. But of course, you can never solve this problem if you don't even think that these people are people to begin with. If you think that homeless people, if your attitude towards homeless people is like inherently violent because they think that they are fucking moral failures or animals or, you know, something less than human, then you're not going to want to solve it. You just want it away. You want to push it away. That's your short-term solution, is just like, get them out, get them out, get them away. I don't care if they fucking die. And that's usually how people operate.
Gina, thank you. One more look at what is truly a crisis, and we hope that our viewers will go and search our documentary.
Okay, Jesus Christ. Anyway, the project website says the center will include mental health services, education programs, job training, and job placement assistance. And the fact is that 2,000 or 5,000 or 10,000 is just not acceptable in any place to give fair treatment to these people, said Reverend John Moretta of the Resurrection Catholic Church. These are people that need treatment. You just can't put them in an apartment and say that solves the problem. They need deep, deep help. No, you can. You should give them deep, deep help, but the help starts with an apartment. Opponents worry the plan would draw too many unhoused people into the neighborhood who would be ineligible for treatment of the facility and end up back on the street. We really want the public to understand that we know that we have a housing crisis. We do. We are not against the homeless. They also said their neighborhood has been neglected for too long and needs more economic opportunity and services. Yes, KTLA is owned by Nexstar. Yes, all local media is owned by right-wing multi-billionaire corporations. Corporations that are owned by, you know, right-wing multi-billionaires. Always. The proposal would have been have to be approved by city officials, among others. LA Councilman Kevin DeLeon, who represents Boyle Heights, told KTLA, until such time as a developer can prove to the community their concept meets the interests of Boyle Heights residents, I stand opposed. KTLA attempted to contact the developers, but so far not spoken to them. Here is another weird reality of living in the United States of America. There was a grandma in Arizona that was arrested for feeding people in need.
Well, I'm going to call my higher-ups and figure out how we're going to handle this, okay?
My name is Norma Thornton. I live in Bullhead City, Arizona.
Norma Thornton was donating her time and food to feed the hungry at a community park in Bullhead City, Arizona.
Full color front and back.
Come see Eric.
Okay, so I've made contact with the lady and a gentleman that was here. I went up and talked to her. I said, what are you doing? She goes, I'm just bringing the transients some food. They're hungry.
Transients.
Yeah, so I just got a very, I'm not on speakerphone, right?
They're humans. Transient is like such a red flag for me. The moment that I hear someone say vagrant or transient, I'm like, okay, I'm talking to a fucking guy who's like a freak, okay? And I hear it so goddamn frequently. Los Angeles libs love using those terms, okay?
Yeah, you are. I'll take you off.
Against his better judgment, this officer was instructed to arrest Norma and take her to the station to be fingerprinted.
I think this is a PR nightmare, but okay. Here's the bad news.
Uh-oh.
You're under arrest.
I am?
Yes, for violating the city ordinance. Good news is, all I'm going to do, get your fingerprints, all that stuff, and I will bring you right back here.
The city of Bullhead has made it.
By the way, remember, this is why we say, this is why people say ACAB, okay? This is why, like, that guy might be a good person overall. It seems like he is like, okay, this is a bit fucked up that we're arresting an old lady, but he still ended up arresting that old lady because that's your job. When you're a cop, you're supposed to arrest old ladies when your fucking bosses tell you you gotta arrest this old lady for the reason, for the crime of fucking feeding homeless people.
A crime. To feed the needy.
Technically, I'm supposed to be handcuffing you and everything too, but I'm not gonna do that. I don't think you're a hardened criminal. I don't think you're out to hurt me.
I'm not out to hurt anybody.
The officer issued Norma a citation to appear in court.
Just so you know, you are under arrest. This is an arrest. You must go to court. Do not come back into the park and feed people. If you do, you will definitely spend the night in the jail in Kingman. I had a restaurant for a very long time and I worked restaurant work for quite a bit. A friend of mine had been volunteering, making food for the homeless.
Bro, these motherfuckers would kill Jesus, okay? Like, I mean, this is so Christ-like, I'm losing it, you know? You know they're like, this is the Christian way. You don't understand. That's what you're supposed to do as a Christian, brother.
And ask me would I please be interested in serving food one day a week. And I found it very exciting and so volunteered. This gave me purpose and a good way to use my skill and kind of spiraled to doing more and more. I started out a wonderful day. I had good food, made up for my for the people down at the park. I just finished up serving approximately 26 or 27 people. And the very last person that came through, I literally was scraping the bottom of my pants, finished off the food, gave him. And as he was walking away, these two police officers drove up, Bullhead City Police. Finally, the day came.
Can I just, dude, United States, okay? A country where this statement has really happened. Norma was required to go to court for the crime of feeding the hungry. That's crazy, man. That's crazy. Even when individuals take matters in their own hands to do the right thing, the system still's like, nah, fuck that. You can't do that, bitch. Get the fuck out of here. We're arresting you. We're throwing you in fucking jail. I'm losing my mind. And then people get mad at me for my statements about how America's a dog shit fucking piece of shit country. Oof. Jesus Christ. Crazy. Absolutely bananas.
Finally, the day came to come and talk to the prosecutor person. And then they would set a date for criminal court. So. Thought of people being hungry. I mean, I'm not making a big impact. It's not that much. But at least some people have enough food to survive. And I can't even imagine living in this country and being hungry. To be told that you cannot feed the hungry, regardless of what the circumstances are. It's sad, but it makes me really, really angry, to put it bluntly. After the court, this reporter sat down beside me because I was sitting right on the brink of tears. And he sat down, talked to me a little bit, and he said, may I take your picture? He asked me a few questions. The day after, the front page blasts across, grandmother arrested for feeding the homeless or something like that. I'm never gonna stop feeding them, never.
Not feeding the needy in a private alley, but
is
joining with IJ to fight back.
I am still able to serve people. It's not ideal. There's no tables, there's no grass. They get their food and they just sit up against a fence that gives us some shade. When I was serving in the park, word would get out that I was serving, and it was much easier for people to get to me and to the food. We always kept...
Isn't the whole argument that we shouldn't do personal charities of the government helping people? Dude. I still do charity, okay? I criticize those who think it's the end of the problem. It is unimaginable that someone would prosecute someone who is purely out of the kindness of their heart, taking matters in their own hands and trying to help those less fortunate than they are. Charity and the existence of charity or the necessity for charity indicates systemic failure, but that doesn't mean you should stop doing it, okay? This is something that a lot of people do not understand. Yes, her actions will not solve homelessness in Arizona, clearly. No matter what happens, okay? Even if every single individual in Arizona was like, let's do our best, let's fucking do our best to feed homeless people, you're still not going to You're still not going to solve homelessness in Arizona. Because homelessness is not happening because people are not offering food to the needy. It's happening because people are getting priced out of the housing market. And even this grandma recognizes that reality.
The park clean so that the place is always left as clean or cleaner than we arrived. Nobody camped in the park, lived in the park. The city has made it very clear that I can have a party and host up to 100 people with no consequence at all, so long as I am not feeding the homeless.
Yeah, they've decided that the way to tackle homelessness in Arizona is by making it criminal to share food with them.
I am not enabling homelessness. I'm enabling these people to survive.
Yeah, they say that's their attitude. They say it's a public hazard because the more they eat, the more they poop. And also that you're enabling homelessness.
Political reporter Morgan Reiner breaks down the timeline of what's happening behind the scenes to try and fix us all.
The problem is, like, the idea that, like, homelessness will go away if you make it illegal is demonstrably a failure, because every single city that has experienced homelessness has created new provisions to make it harder to be homeless, right? Loitering laws and shit like that are created specifically to criminalize poverty and criminalize being homeless in public. However, homelessness is still growing. And the reason for why is not because our measures are not aggressive enough. The reason is something different. It must be something different. Well, we know what the reason is. It's because they don't have housing. It's because they're getting priced out of housing. The more you push the current homeless people aside and, like, push them further and further, the outskirts of society, let's say, the more you think you're actually, you know, solving the problem immediately for the real estate developers without harming anyone that truly matters, right? The real estate developers and the fucking wealthy voters and whatnot. Except, why is it still growing? Because there's new people becoming homeless. Why are they becoming homeless is not a question that people ever ask. People do not ever ask why homelessness is growing in this fucking country. Well, the ones that do ask that question oftentimes have shitty answers for it. What do they say? Well, they say it's because, you know, mental health is becoming a bigger problem. Oh, mental health's the reason. No, motherfucker, that's not the reason.
Right now, Morgan.
One homeless organization told me that's the million-dollar question. How long will it take to solve this issue? But the issue wasn't created overnight, and it's not going to be solved overnight. We are in this for the long haul.
San Diego Mayor Todd Gloria said two things can be true at the same time.
We've increased shelter capacity in our city by 38%. We've done that largely by utilizing public facilities and properties.
The city is sheltering more homeless individuals, but more people are becoming homeless.
In the city of San Diego, our median rent is somewhere around $2,600 a month for an apartment. You know, it's no surprise if you have rental rates of that nature that you're going to see more folks on the streets.
In part because of the high cost of living and mental health and drug addiction.
People continue to be extremely frustrated. They don't see the progress that they would expect to see with this all hands on deck effort.
From San Diego to Bakersfield.
We hear from businesses and residents who are experiencing the impact.
To Sacramento.
We saw about a 67% increase.
Statewide poll.
67% increase, bro. The more you support lazy people, the more they will take advantage of it. Why work when the government will take care of you? Love that. Dude, you've solved it, my friend. You fucking solved it. That's right, dude. I've never heard that take before. Thanks so much. I know. That's the reason why I think, like, why is the government taking care of you by sending you to public school? You should actually learn by fucking continuing to hit your head into a wall and hoping that this information materializes in your brain, getting dumber and dumber and dumber. Okay? That's awesome, man. No, keep it up, brother. You're fucking killing it. You've solved it. Fucking cuck. That's why in places that have more, that's why in places where they have adequate shelter or adequate social safety nets, better social safety nets, people are literally just not working. I think of Finland and I'm always like, man, country famous for not working. Everyone is literally on the government doll, dude. Everyone's on the government dollar. It's crazy, dude. It's just 100% unemployment. Who knows how they survive? Nobody understands it. It's crazy. They've just built an entire economy while not working. Same with Germany. Same with all these other places like Austria, another famous place where people are just simply not working because they've gotten too lazy because the government's helping them out too much. How do they do it, I wonder? Dude, you are so cucked. Let me tell you something. You are not the Walton family. You are not the Koch family. You are not George Soros. You are not one of Sheldon Adelson's grandchildren. You are a worker. Your parents were a worker before you, and if you're lucky, you will continue to be a worker and not become homeless. Okay? Those guys get a fuckload of help from the government. They get subsidies. They're seen as productive people. They get tax breaks. They get more money back. They get help all the time. But you, as a worker, don't even want social safety nets for your other fellow workers because you think one day you'll be like him. But you are not him. You are not Hemi Neutron. Okay? You're not them. Shut the fuck up about government help and how it creates laziness. That is a lie that those who get the most government help, that get all the government help, have told you. So dumb motherfuckers like you who desperately need the government help, and in some instances this could just mean free healthcare, by the way, will repeat that lie over and over again because you got peasant brain. Okay? You're a goddamn peasant. You're living like a fucking medieval peasant right now. And you don't even recognize it.
Poll after poll says the same thing. People are frustrated.
There is no single bullet that's going to solve our problem overnight.
Lisa Bates runs Sacramento Steps Forward. They conduct the point in time count for the area. She says solutions are in the works. The governor signed several bills last month that will help streamline the process to build new affordable housing.
From a regulatory standpoint, they've done a lot. But, you know, housing takes time to build, to develop, to site.
Her organization worked with the city and county to come up with a 3-year local plan.
We need to do a lot more on the front end. We need to catch people early and prevent homelessness from occurring.
To address mental health, the governor passed Care Court to compel those with severe mental illness into treatment and housing. But again, that won't be implemented statewide for another few years.
We'll start to see the kinds of reductions in on-street visible homelessness amongst the severely mentally ill that I think is the most concerning to Californians.
When Newsom was running for office back in 2017, he pledged to build 3.5 million homes by 2025 because that's what experts predict that we need in order to address the shortage. But we are nowhere near that. Newsom recently admitted that it was a stretch goal. So instead, he changed that goal to 2.5 million homes by 2030. Again, from the local level to the state level, there are dozens of projects in the works, but all of them are going to take time.
That's crazy, man. We just can't be building houses out here, bro. It's wild. I wonder why we can't be building houses out here. And then when we do end up building houses, it's all fucking luxury condominiums that just are never full. I don't know who's buying the luxury condos, by the way. I haven't seen it, okay? I wish I knew. Those motherfuckers look so empty all the goddamn time. Dude, look at Culver City. Holy fuck, dude. It's crazy. It's crazy. You know who's buying them? They're building it for someone. They're buying them. You know who's buying them? Investors, okay? Airbnb Anders and also other investors. Anders. Oh, my God. Capitalists be like,
yeah, that'll show those poor.
Why are you cheering, Fry? You're not rich.
True, but someday I might be rich, and then people like me better watch their step.
Yeah, that's what you sound like when you fucking when you advocate for the needs of the wealthy, for the interest, for the better interests of the wealthy. Okay, let's talk about, this is the last thing we're going to cover here on this issue, on this matter. But as far as Cenk goes, yes, he's in the wrong, okay? He's in the wrong. I understand why so many fucking liberals' brains have been broken by seeing crime and fucking homelessness and all this shit, right? Cenk hates Karen Bass, understandably. Karen Bass sucks, but she's still, unfortunately, better than motherfucking Rick Caruso, who is like, almost single-handedly responsible. If there's like a singular individual that has like reinforced structural oppression, okay, that has been a cause, almost personally been a cause to creating more homeless people in Los Angeles and in California in general, it's motherfuckers like Rick Caruso, bro. Okay? So here is what could be done.
Livable apartments have become a luxury in many large cities. Vienna, however, has deliberately chosen a different path. For over,
by the way, this is directly a consequence of communists and socialists. I don't know what they're going to say, but like, yeah, no, it is literally communists and socialists that created the structure that has made it so that 65% of people living in Vienna live in public housing. It's not even a joke. It is.
For 100 years, we have considered affordable housing a public responsibility that is best met by an effective public housing sector.
To understand Vienna's unique housing situation, you have to know its history. At the beginning of the 20th century, it had more than 2 million inhabitants, a larger population size than in the present day. At that time, about 300,000 people in the city had no access to decent living space. Vienna was reputed to be the European capital with the worst housing. As a result, the Social Democratic Viennese government made concerted efforts to improve living standards after World War I. The dogma was, apartments are not goods. Having one is a right. In 1923, the foundation for the first large residential construction program was laid. A new municipal city council decree foresaw the construction of 25,000 apartments within 5 years, and another 30,000 from 1929 to 1933. Public housing projects were never limited to certain districts. They were implemented across Vienna, regardless of the social status of the area. Owing to this clear, long-standing policy, the social background of a person cannot be determined by their postal address. The most essential principles of the Austrian First Republic are still valid today. These include affordable, high-quality buildings, social cohesion, and a balanced social mix. As a result, social housing.
City planning impacts people's lives, and if you have mixed income housing, like they're describing here, and everyone gets the same nice housing readily available to them, you will have better social cohesion. It is a fundamental part of city building, okay? Yes, it is quite literally Soviet style. That's just how it works. That is true. That's how it works. When your neighbors are from all different backgrounds, you become you have more social cohesion. This is how equal opportunity works, by the way. America will never do this, though, because they look at this and say, that's socialism, that's terrible.
Has a long and successful tradition that has now lasted for more than 100 years. It is this continuity which is unique. Nowadays, Vienna, Austria's capital, is home to 1.9 million inhabitants. Along with New York and Geneva, it is home to the United Nations and other important global diplomatic organizations. It is the fifth largest capital in the European Union and the second largest city in the German-speaking world. Today, more than half of all Viennese live in subsidized apartments. These housing complexes are spread across the city, ensuring a positive social mix in each district. Vienna is the fastest growing city in the German-speaking world. Although the growth of population slowed down in recent years, it is still expanding at around 10,000 people per year. And this high ratio is expected to continue over the next few years.
Yeah, I'll be back.
The pressure on the municipality to provide the population with attractive and affordable apartments in a healthy, safe, and livable environment is huge. Hence, local government invests up to 400 million euros annually in housing construction and renovation of older buildings. Another 100 million euros is reserved for local residents who are unable to afford even subsidized rents. The subsidies are financed through federal taxes and the general income tax system. This funding through taxation creates a reliable basis for the planning of complex housing programs, which would be impossible under strictly market-dependent housing policies. The quota is regulated by a federal law and amounts to 0.5% of the gross income of employees and employers. On the basis of this tax, Vienna receives an annual amount of about 250 million euros for housing construction purposes from the federal state. Besides money, there are other important factors that help tenants sleep well at night. City dwellers enjoy a very strong tenancy law in Austria. Another essential factor is the Limited Profit Housing Act. This act provides the legal framework for all limited profit construction associations, whether organized as a cooperative or as a corporation. It defines not only the principles of the public good status, but also other issues, such as the handling of rents or the membership of a supervisory association. Another key factor for affordable housing was the establishment of the Vienna Land Distribution and Urban Renewal Fund in 1984 to provide land for state-subsidized housing construction and to supervise the renovation of old houses. As a non-profit organization, Wohn von Wien, as it is called today, coordinates property developers, house owners, municipal departments and service centers of the municipality of Vienna. Because of its land reserves and long-term planning, Wohn von Wien is still able to buy agricultural or brownfield land at good rates despite the increasing price of land. Recent years have seen land and real estate prices in many European cities spiraling out of control. To counteract this development, the city of Vienna amended its building code in November 2018 by introducing the subsidized housing zoning category. If land is thus classified as belonging to a subsidized housing zone, two-thirds of the usable floor space created for housing purposes must be taken up by subsidized dwellings. This caps rents and safeguards that affordable homes will continue to be constructed across the entire city, and again, ensures a good social mix all over Vienna. All these measures provide for an adequate supply of good housing in Vienna, as well as the rest of Austria. Last but not
least, is there a catch, or am I too American to think this is something that can happen without weird consequences? The consequence that's weird is that everyone has some level of housing, okay? Like almost every single person has adequate housing at that point. That it is a weird consequence if you're used to, you know, living in fucking filth as the system just constantly fucks you over. That it is weird. It's unimaginable if you're American, especially.
Not least, these benefits contribute to Vienna being continually voted the city with the highest standard of living in the world.
How is rent subsidized? I don't know, dog. What do you think taxes do? Like, people always are like, how are we going to pay for it? It's like, bro, you already pay for shit. It's just the American government decides to use your payments for a never-ending war machine, okay? And subsidies for mega corporations. We privatize everything.
Vienna was ranked as the most livable city worldwide 10 times in a row. This includes Quality of Living Ranking 2019 by Mercer, as well as being classified as the best place to live worldwide by the Global Livability Index 2019 through The Economist. in comparison with other big cities, Vienna has rather moderate rent prices. To maintain this, even in times when the housing market is under great pressure due to the financial markets and the ever-increasing population, the city administration invests, as mentioned, annually roughly 400 million euros in housing construction and renovation of older buildings. With this funding budget, around 7,000 good quality affordable apartments are built every year, and over 5,000 apartments refurbished on average. Nowadays, the benchmark rent for a well-equipped municipal apartment is €5.81 per square meter.
Looked up some of the private housing protected by Vienna's policies, and even there, like $410 a month, utilities included, and that's private. Yeah, because when your housing market prices are dictated by affordable public housing, private housing owners and people who want to rent, people who want to become landlords, are going to have a much harder fucking time because the government has set the pricing that way. That's why people always talk about how they don't want the government to interfere with business. Okay? Why do you think they're always like, yo, don't let the government interfere in business, brother. The free market needs to do shit. Competition needs to thrive. The real reason why they don't want the government to interfere is because the government is always going to outcompete. The government is always going to fucking put the price ceiling at such a low point that all these private businesses and their profit margins are going to get fucking eviscerated, and they can suck my cock, especially when we're talking about a commodity that is a necessity for survival.
Excluding taxes and operating costs, the benchmark rent for a subsidized apartment is nearly the same. When we study how people live, we can determine that Vienna is a city of tenants. Over three quarters of Vienna's population rent accommodation, with only around 20% living in flats or houses that they own. There are mainly two forms of affordable housing in Vienna: the municipal housing apartments owned by the City of Vienna and the non-profit residential construction buildings owned and operated by non- or limited-profit cooperatives or associations. Already since the 1950s, parallel to the social housing construction of the Viennese municipality, non-profit housing construction has been making a considerable contribution to apartment production. Responsible for the building management of the Viennese municipal housing complexes is Wiener Wohnen, Vienna's municipal housing company. With 4,000 employees, Wiener Wohnen is Europe's largest manager of municipal properties. Altogether, Wiener Wohnen looks after 1,800 housing complexes, containing 220,000 apartments, more than 5,000 business premises or doctor's practices, and nearly 50,000 garages and outdoor parking spots. And although the City of Vienna recently decided to build another 4,000 new municipal housing units, most efforts have been made since the early 2000s to promote the concept of subsidized housing. This program is supported by non- or limited-profit construction associations, which are responsible for building, renovating, and administrating apartments for the benefit of the general public. These must be approved by the federal state government as charitable. Such building associations belong to a federation watchdog which regularly reviews their business activities. Non-profit building associations predominantly build dwellings that are subsidized according to the Housing Development Acts of the provinces. Therefore, for the rent or purchase of an apartment, the funding provisions must be complied with. To ensure that the quality of affordable housing in Vienna fulfills the highest quality standards, Vienna has a detailed planning process, including rigorous competitions for selecting developers and architects. This is called the Four Pillars process. Only those projects which provide the highest standards in the fields of economy, ecology, architecture, and social sustainability will be selected by an interdisciplinary panel of experts. For housing construction projects with a volume of at least 500 subsidized dwellings, developer competitions are mandatory. smaller projects are evaluated by the Land Advisory
Board. Chatter's about to become fluent in German. You might want to brush up so you can be a German streamer. Yeah, we're moving to Österreich.
Board, which is also a part of Wohnfonds.
It's just, it is kind of funny to consider that, like, a fucking European country, like, in this current day and age, has policies that literally seem unimaginable for America. Like, Americans look at this and go, that's utopian communism. You look to fucking, I don't know, half of the European social democracies and their healthcare system, their public education system is so well-funded and operates so well, and you think that is utopian communism. None of this is, by the way, but dude, you know what I mean? Like, we are living in such dire circumstances here in the wealthiest nation on earth that, like, other countries have been able to manage all this shit, and we look at that and go, nah, dude, that's crazy. That will not happen. You're fucking bullshit. That would never happen, dude.
Both systems use similar criteria to determine eligibility for housing. You have to have a minimum age of 18.
They literally kept this going because they were scared of the socialism in the 20th century after World War II. Yes. The USSR's, perhaps the USSR's single most important contribution to humanity, aside from eviscerating the Nazi scourge, of course, was that its existence galvanized trade unionists, socialists, communists in all of these other Western nations that created a system, a mechanism of fear that led capitalists to concede. The only reason why so many of these countries have healthcare, so many of these countries have, like, viable and robust union systems, the only reason why these countries have public transit and all of these amenities that are impossible, that are seemingly, like, a fucking unicorn or dream in America, is because capital owners and capitalists in general were terrified of a communist revolution or a communist takeover or a trade unionist takeover, and therefore conceded. The last time this happened in America is when we got the New Deal, okay, under FDR. Same forces, similar forces of pressure created a system and an environment where even a social democrat or a relatively open-minded leader who was terrified of those formations coming in and seizing power and seizing control decided to basically concede and cave and give in to those desires, those pressures.
Maximum monthly income must not be more than 3,410 euros after tax with a single person, 5,080 euros and 71 cents for a two-person household, and 5,750 euros for a three-person household. These relatively high income limits, 75% of the Viennese population earn less, provide that the middle class also has access to Vienna's subsidized housing. Everybody who wants to rent public housing must have lived in Vienna for at least 2 years. You have to be an Austrian citizen, come from a member state of the European Union, or have an equivalent status. To get one of the municipal housing flats, or a smart apartment, or a subsidized apartment with a procuration fee under 10,000 euros, you also have to fulfill socially oriented allocation criteria. The long-standing history of affordable housing in Vienna and the ongoing political will and practice that maintains it makes Vienna a great place to live. Constantly providing its residents with affordable homes needs constant commitment and a wealth of action. As in the past, this action will ensure future generations have access to high-quality, affordable apartments.
Oh, fuck. I'm muted. I'm sorry. Okay. Yo, that shit goes hard on mute. You know what I'm saying? Dude, I was spitting too. I'll never spit again. I'll never say those incredible things I just said. You will never hear them again. That's it. That's the last time. It's the first and last time I'll spit so fucking hard, dude. I said some things that would have gotten me on Fox News again. Okay. Imagine actually investing the colonialism money into the poor. I mean, that's what Europe did. You know what I mean? A lot of Europe did. A lot of, like, European development hinges on quite literally that. You know what I mean? Except Britain. No, Britain did that too. What do you mean? They got the NHS and shit. Come on. Anyway, imagine being single, making $3,400 a month with like $500 rent for housing. That will be privatized very soon. Don't say that. Don't say that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back to Pooty Poo. We're back to Pooty Poo. Vladimir Putin, not a good guy. Okay? Not a particularly good guy. Very bad guy. Recently said or made claims on top of the routine yearly ICBM testing military games that they played, which, of course, America was informed ahead of time. That was on schedule. Nothing too weird there, at least according to the U.S. State Department. But on top of that, he said something along the lines of Ukraine will perhaps use a dirty bomb. Would I call him a knucklehead? Oh, I don't know if I could go that far. That seems pretty rough, man. I mean, that's... I don't know. You know what? Why not? Yeah, he is. He is a big stinker. A knucklehead. That guy. Dude, it's over. I'm fucking getting... I'm getting dosed with, like, radiated uranium.
Vladimir Putin, meantime, blaming the West for playing what he calls a dangerous, bloody, and dirty game around the world. And... he says, for seeking global domination. The Russian president making these comments at an event going on as we speak in Moscow. He also said the West shouldn't tell Russia how to build its society, while adding that Russia does not consider itself an enemy of the West. And he had a prediction for Russia's future. Have a listen.
Of course, we have some problems, and our losses due to special military operation. But we have economic losses too. But we have massive gains. And what is happening, without any doubt, in the end of the day, and I want to emphasize, in the end of the day, will be for the good of Russia and its future.
To the situation on Ukraine's front lines, President Zelensky accusing Russian troops of, quote, craziness in the eastern Donetsk region. Three civilians reportedly killed as Russian forces keep trying to take the city of Bakhmut. Now, that's been a long, months-long effort with only small gains. Mr. Zelensky mocked Russia for focusing so much firepower there with so little to show for it. Well, Ukraine's president also sounding very confident about the prospect of taking back the southern city of Kherson. He says his forces will besiege the Russians if they stay. One of his advisers earlier warning that the heaviest of battles against occupying Russian forces there is set to come. CNN's Fred Plykin reports from near the front lines close to that city.
Ukrainian forces trying to hit the Russians on all fronts. This mortar unit firing in the north of the country, while in the south, Kiev is continuing a counter-offensive trying to capture the Russian-occupied city of Kherson. We met up with an artillery unit on the battlefield.
The soldiers tell us there's firing going on here pretty much every day, several times a day. The front line is not very far from where we are at all. It's a couple of kilometers in that direction. And right now, there's not very much movement on that front line, but still, the situation is very dangerous.
Ukraine's defense minister says Kiev's counter...
Do you think we should cancel Putin? Oh, man, I don't know. That seems like a bridge too far, man. Oh, not deplatforming, I mean. Yeah, you know what? Yeah, we should. We should cancel Putin.
Complicated by wet weather in the area. But the commander says he believes in the end they will oust the Russians.
I know one thing for sure. We will never step back from here. We have no other choice, only forward. Ukraine has to get back all its territory and borders.
While Russia continues to mobilize hundreds of thousands for the war here, the Ukrainians say they found the Wagner Private Military Company, founded by Putin ally Yevgeny Prigozhin, is sending Russian prisoners with diseases to the front line, the chief of Ukraine's military intelligence told CNN's Nick Robertson.
They put on them certain wristbands in blue, white, or red color. Every color signifies tuberculosis, hepatitis, or HIV. It's happening on a mass scale. Most of them who were taken prisoners or their dead bodies, which were found in the battlefield, had those wristbands.
CNN can't independently verify those.
Yeah, I don't believe that. I mean, but Wagner is Nazi shit. They're like the Blackwater of Russia. But also, no, I don't. That sounds unhinged. That doesn't really matter. Also, what the fuck is CNN doing? Like, you just reported on that while simultaneously being like, we cannot independently verify that. Okay, well then why'd you put that in there?
Those claims, as Russian forces continue to lose ground in Ukraine, the Kremlin conducting massive annual nuclear drills involving submarine-launched ballistic missiles and others launched from Russia's fleet of strategic bombers. While the Russians notified the U.S. about the drills well in advance, Russian President Vladimir Putin with a clear warning to Washington.
What they are trying to achieve, we see on the example of Ukraine, which has become an instrument of American foreign policy. The country is practically lost.
CNN said, trust me, bro. Source, we don't know. He didn't even say, trust me, bro. CNN just literally said, we don't know about that. But, you know, maybe they're doing it. Which is crazy.
Sovereignty and is directly controlled from the United States.
But the Ukrainians on the front line say they are fighting for their own freedom, not for anybody else. Fred Plotkin, CNN, Mykolaiv, Ukraine.
But we begin with new allegations against...
For the record, I'm not disagreeing with, like, whether Wagner is, like, recruiting prisoners or not. I'm talking about the biological warfare component of it. You know, because I don't think that's how that works. Like, I don't think you can conduct biological warfare like that. There is also another component of Ukraine and the Russia situation that I wanted to cover that I haven't been able to cover for a while, which was the Congressional Progressive Caucus. Now, the CPC, led by led by Jaipal. Jaipal. Fuck. Jaipal. Hold on. I'm gonna pull up a YouTube video of this as well. Decided to come out with a press release and decided to come out with a letter. Okay. The Congressional Progressive Caucus chair statement on Ukraine letter. Now, they went back on it very quickly because people were incredibly unhinged about it. I didn't actually see their... Hold on. I didn't even actually see their original take on the matter. But from what I understand, their original take on the matter was not, like, insane or anything like that. It was more so that we need to... Here it is. People are furious. Jaipal withdraws letter on Ukraine policy amid Democratic anger. Now, the reason why I feel comfortable covering this, other than the fact that because people are going to rip my asshole apart because they're just basically saying things that I've been saying for a while now, which is that, like, the aid is already conditional, and the conditions that the American aid is on hinges on is the continued effort of, like, fighting till every last Ukrainian. Some of the Ukrainians on the ground might want that, but ultimately that's not what's best for Ukraine in general. And the conditional aid should also come with the condition that, like, diplomatic ties should never be closed off, or some kind of treaty should never be fucking pushed aside, cast aside. I've not seen any American politicians come out and openly state this before. 30 members came out and said something. They wrote a fucking letter, and liberals became the most unhinged people on the fucking planet, immediately stating that these... Oh, fuck. Oh, no. I think Jack's here already. God damn it. You're right on fucking time. Fuck. Hold on. Let's watch this.
Stunning turn of events and a massive unforced error, really, right ahead of the midterm elections. Moments ago, liberal Democrats withdrew an open letter they sent to President Biden suggesting the U.S. try to negotiate with Vladimir Putin to end his invasion in Ukraine. Now, that sparked fierce backlash within the party. Democratic Congressman Jake Auchincloss tweeting, quote, "This letter is an olive branch to a war criminal who's losing his war." The Congressional Progressive Caucus chairwoman, Pramila Jayapal, even defended the letter initially, but now she's saying it was sent by mistake. Let's get right to Manu Raju on Capitol Hill. Manu, what's going on here? What's the truth?
Yeah, a number of these members who actually signed this letter that was released this week were surprised. They said they were blindsided. I talked to some of them.
So, where is it? Does anyone have the original letter? I need to know. I want to go through the original letter. So from what I understand, it was basically, just like, hey, we should always keep diplomatic avenues open, and that, obviously Russia is murderous, monstrous, but ultimately diplomatic avenues should be maintained with Russia. Here it is. Because ultimately all wars end in treaties, no matter what. Even if one side wins and the other side loses, ultimately who is losing is the working class of either side, and even other surrounding nations that rely on Ukraine for wheat, for example. House progressives float diplomatic path towards ending war in Ukraine, get annihilated, and quickly clarify. So the Progressive Caucus and 30 members of the Congressional Progressive Caucus sent a letter to the White House that attempted to gingerly open a conversation about a potential diplomatic end to Russia's war on Ukraine. The door was slammed shut by the evening, met with enough fury to elicit a clarification in the form of a statement from the caucus chair, Pramila Jayapal. Okay? Let me be clear, Jayapal said in the statement issued before 7 p.m., we are united as Democrats in our unequivocal commitment to supporting Ukraine in their fight for their democracy and the freedom in the face of the illegal and outrageous Russian invasion, and nothing in the letter advocates for a change in that support. On Tuesday afternoon, Jaipal followed the clarification by fully withdrawing the letter, saying it was released by staff without vetting. So Jaipal threw her staff under the bus for a general suggestion of diplomacy to end a war, then pled guilty to the greatest crime of Washington today, giving the appearance of agreeing with the other party. Letter suggesting diplomacy was withdrawn. Unacceptable, unimaginable, shows everything that I've been talking about with respect to shows everything that I've been talking about with respect to how fucking bloodthirsty liberals are, especially in this day and age. We have now become little fucking lobbyists and talking persons for the American war machine on each side. Okay? Mind-boggling that you can't even fucking come out and say understandable, reasonable things. The letter itself also featured, if I'm not mistaken, the letter itself also featured statements about, of course, giving Ukrainians full autonomy in the treaty process and allowing them to make these decisions on their own. It was simply more to say, we should also be on the side of ending this quickly. Okay? That Monday morning, Washington Post reported that CPC members were urging President Joe Biden to dramatically shift his stance on the Ukraine war and pursue direct negotiations with Russia, the first time prominent members of his own party have pushed him to change his approach to Ukraine. Such diplomacy could ultimately end with Russia gaining territory by force, even as it's faltering on the battlefield. That the letter was met with fierce opposition is a measure of the space available for debate among congressional Democrats when it comes to support for the war and how it might be stopped before it turns nuclear. That is roughly zero. I voted for every defense package to Ukraine and stand firmly for Ukraine's sovereignty, says Representative Rokana, a letter signer. That's what he told The Intercept. It should not be controversial to say we need to explore every diplomatic avenue to seek a just peace to end the war, including the engagement of our allies to help with that. It's literally what I've been saying for fucking months. And of course, predictably, the exact same way that people fucking shit on me and shove those sentiments down my goddamn throat. They shoved it down the Congressional Progressive Caucus throat as well, okay? And it got so fucking insane. The war-hungry, bloodthirsty, NATO-adjacent liberals and so-called progressives have gotten so out of pocket that they even lost the Pod Save crew. The fucking Pod Johns were critical of the reaction to Jayapal and the Congressional Progressive Caucus's, you know, tiny little letter. Okay.
Here. You make the right point that what Biden's saying is I won't negotiate around the settlement that Ukraine has to accept without them. That doesn't mean we don't have things to talk to the Russians about. It just right. means Biden's not going to sit there and say, well, maybe you can keep this part of Ukraine and not that part of Ukraine. That's not going to happen. But to your point, if you don't create any space for kind of debate in the center here around this policy, you know where all the concerns about the war are going to go? They're going to go to where Kevin McCarthy took it,
right? Totally.
Which is that, like, hey, I'm getting uncomfortable here. There's nuclear threats. Let's cut off the Ukrainians, right?
It's a lot of money.
So, you know, to some of you, like some of the Ukraine stands on Twitter or whatever, who like just, you know, pile.
Don't worry about it. That's why I said, like, chill while I eat and I cover this and then I can bring you in. Jack Wagner's here, everybody. And we're going to talk about his latest podcast. But before we do that, I'm going to finish this up.
On this stuff, you might be creating the outcome you don't want, because by punishing anybody who says let's have diplomacy, the only alternative to your position, you know, is where Kevin McCarthy's going, which is like, hey, let's cut these, where Tucker Carlson is, basically.
Or where Elon Musk. I mean, there's clearly a void of people.
There's a void of
and like
discussion.
Elon Musk is filling it, or that guy David Sachs, some like idiot tech investor, right wing goober is filling it. You know, it's like, why don't we have the CPC, the progressive in the House fill it, or at least try.
Well, that would be a very healthy place to fill it.
They're absolutely correct. I've said this time and time again about Tucker Carlson's prominence when he was the only voice in mainstream media that has that openly was talking about like workers' rights, even though that was just a vehicle for him to shove in white nationalist rhetoric. If you allow the only fucking people to talk about workers and workers' rights to be white nationalists and white supremacists in media, and you don't have any earnest and honest voices that care about the rights of laborers, you are going to lose ground and you are going to allow right-wing populism to basically become the only reasonable voice in the room at a time when, you know, the contradictions under capitalism are becoming more apparent and frustrating people.
Yeah, this letter, if you read it, like, it's literally just saying that we should be exploring diplomacy with Russia. There's nothing.
It's like a restatement of policy.
There's literally nothing objectionable in the letter whatsoever.
Yeah. Did Mr. Blowhard ask Ukrainians or Eastern Europeans what they want? Nope, it's never done. Paint them as stands. Meanwhile, the same rationale is never applied to issues in the general left completely ignore. Yeah. Great. Awesome. Yeah, you're right. We're not. We're not asking the Eastern... We're not asking the Eastern Europeans or the Ukrainians what they want. Bro, what are you talking about? We've given, like, fucking hundreds of billions of dollars of weapons. What the fuck do you mean? All wars now in a nuclearized military, nuclearized state, when we have mutually assured destruction, all wars either end with nuclear winter or some form of treaty, okay? That's it. There is already a point that we don't go past. Okay? And the point that we don't go past is invoking Article 5. The point that we don't go past is like actually putting boots on the ground and engaging people, engaging the Russian forces with our forces. Ukrainians want that, and we're not giving it to them. Why not? Because that is nuclear annihilation. Anyone that claims that they're like listening to the demands of the Ukrainians is fucking lying. That's not true. They're not. Anyway, it's insane to me that the Congressional Progressive Caucus came out with this letter and then immediately rescinded it. Especially considering that how milquetoast the letter was, especially considering that like the letter itself did not feature any sort of like unhinged idea. It was like pretty basic stuff. And even then they got bullied into fucking pulling back support. And the reason why I wanted to cover it is because it shows like how fucking crazy we have become, how bloodthirsty we are on the liberal side. Here, let me finish this out.
And who said they did not
as much food in my mouth as possible. But also at the top of the hour, the 6-second ad break, I'm going to fucking run that ad really quickly as well. If you no longer want to see those ads, all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or for free with a Twitch Prime by connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account. You can also get gifted a sub if you're lucky. Here's the woman ad break now. Let's continue with the
Diapol's office would release this letter this week. They, in fact, had signed this letter in June, pushing the Biden administration to pursue more diplomacy in the war, Russia's war with Ukraine. But some of them said that if they knew this was going to be released this week, they would never have released it in the, they never would have signed onto it in the first place.
Wait,
one veteran Democratic member
released?
Told me that Democrats were, quote, furious, including some members who were in difficult re-election races who did not want to open up a debate, an inter-party feud about how to deal with Ukraine when the party has united behind sending billions and billions of dollars to Ukraine at a time when Republicans are divided over this issue. So after backlash, Jaipal just announced moments ago that she would retract this letter that was sent to President Biden. She said in her statement, in part, that the idea that conflating the Democratic position with the Republican position concerned about more aid was, quote, nothing could be further from the truth about that. She said, every war ends with diplomacy, and this one will too after Ukrainian victory. The letter sent yesterday, although restating that basic principle, has been conflated with GOP opposition to support for the Ukrainians' just defense of their national sovereignty. As such, it is a distraction at this time, and we withdraw the letter. Now, it has not been yet fully explained why this was released this week. We had asked Jayapal's office about that. They declined to comment about the reason, but after that initial backlash from when it was released on yesterday, she released a statement clarifying the position, saying they support the administration's position, but ultimately untenable as Democrats tried to push back, made clear that they wouldn't have signed on to this letter, forcing an embarrassing about-face from the leader of the Progressive Caucus, someone who has an eye on potentially elevating in the Democratic leadership in the next Congress. But nevertheless, Democrats are hoping to put this feud behind them and move on to the midterm elections where they're focusing on other issues as a struggle to keep control of the House.
Anna. Well, Manu Ranju, thank you for that update. Let's discuss now.
Insanity, madness, you know, and that's where we're at here. CNN witnesses Russia return body of American fighting for Ukraine. Oh, this is the guy that people were saying looks like me, right? All right. Well, Jack is here. I'm just going to have him on. Fuck it. We'll get back to our news coverage in a little bit. Yeah. Here you go. I'm going to be eating because I'm fucking rude, okay?
I know. Here,
pull that in front of you.
What's up, guys?
All these, there you go. It's working, I think.
What are you eating?
I'm eating sweet green.
Okay, so I just want to say I brought you a pumpkin.
You gotta speak super close into the microphone, by the way.
I brought you a pumpkin. I don't expect you to do anything with it right now. You have a lot of food, but
why is this green?
It's from a real pumpkin patch that came from off the vine. So that's I believe that's an heirloom pumpkin.
It smells
I just
pretty
bought
good
it the other day. So that's my Halloween offering to you.
Did you not see the pumpkins that I carved outside in my
No,
door?
I missed those.
Wow. Not
what did would you carve?
Not a good start to how you're supposed to be the Mr. Spooky. Okay. You're supposed to be the
I mean, it would be really spooky if I knew what was outside of your house in advance.
That would be spooky.
But
100%.
I mean, you kind of like ran out, grabbed me, and I just sprinted in.
Yeah, sorry. I was still live, you know?
It's impressive to watch you work. I also have over there the first Otherworld hoodie of all time.
Oh wow. Yeah, okay,
before
yeah.
I even got one.
Get fucking wrecked, Brace.
I know, right?
Get absolutely cumstered, Brace Belden. Mm-hmm. He's CIA. I can't believe you went on the CIA podcast.
Is that a theory now?
That's all. I mean, who doesn't?
Brace is an asset.
Everyone.
It was fun. I spooky pilled them.
Okay,
I wish I could say orange pilled, but I guess like I was saying orange pilled to
orange pilled is
I
there's
guess
a different
Bitcoin,
reason,
right?
No, orange pilled is when you're like really when you're really into like European social democrats and.
Really?
And you believe in, like, adequate public transit. It's not, like, the worst. Orange pilled is not just
bikes.
Is that
even, like, a pill to just want bike lanes or whatever? I feel like that's more natural. I don't know if you need a pill.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. But I guess it's also for Bitcoin, too. I did not know that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's Jack Wagner.
How's it going, guys?
No relation to the Wagner Group or Wagner, the musician.
Thank you so much for having me on. Are you ready to talk ghosts and ghouls?
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about what's going on first and foremost. You have a podcast, yeah, but still.
I haven't even really talked to you about this, have I?
Well, you just kind of said you have a new podcast.
Do you know anything about it? Should I give you the pitch, the full
explanation? Well, I do. I do know. You interview people that have had like, these life-changing spooky experiences, right?
Yeah, the backstory is I started doing this for Yeah But Still. I normally host a comedy podcast called Yeah But Still.
Yeah.
And like the first year, we've been doing it for 5 years. Brandon Wardell is the co-host, or I'm the co-host. We're both co-hosts. But I went rogue one Halloween, and I wanted to get a ghost story. I knew at least one person that had a funny ghost story to tell. So I was like, if I get one more, I'll do like a Patreon episode. And I did a tweet or something, and we were pretty small back then, so I did a tweet asking if anybody had one, and I got so many submissions, dude, and they were crazy, and I started to talk to these people, and it was like,